Praise God, dear heart. Thank you for joining me again today on the Call-In Deliverance Session. I'm your host, Evangelist King. Now, remember, I try to make myself available every Wednesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you can call our Deliverance Conference line number 712-770-4005. And you can enter participant code 828-344. Now, since I have been out the last 4 to 6 weeks, I will be conducting deliverance session on Friday, August the 12th only at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So be sure to call in then if I was not able to get to you on yesterday and today. So I see that 0928 is calling back from yesterday. So I'm going to unmute you to see if you call in for a session. You call in for a session?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, what's your name and the state you calling from?
Marcus James, Alabama.
Oh, this Marcus. Haven't I met
yes.
you before? Okay, how
yes,
you doing,
yes,
Marcus?
Ma'am. I'm doing all right, ma'am.
Okay, what's going on?
Like I said, since last time I called in, I've been experiencing some things, you know what I'm saying? You know, I was part of our walks with the Lord, we have to sometimes go through, but what I've been experiencing a lot, like especially when I stand up for people, like to speak or whatever, like there's this spirit of lust that tries to attach itself on me, and a lot of times I'm having to struggle with that, and I don't know what the root cause of that, and I've been praying about it for a minute, and also this fear, this spirit of fear, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes it will come, so I've been battling those two things. You know, since last time I called in, and I've been trying to ask, like, God, what is the root of this? Like, God, show me, you know, is it something that I might have done that have opened up the door for this? But I know that since last time, and those things have really been trying to, you know, cause stuff in my life, you know what I'm saying? And you know.
Mm-hmm. So since you asked the Lord, has the Lord answered you? Have he showed you anything?
You know what I'm saying? Some things have come into my mind, like you know, I know that, you know, a lot of times with the women dressing sometimes, you know, in churches nowadays, I know that probably could be some, but I know that it most time it happens, like, when I stand before people, like, when I'm teaching Sunday school in my church, like, even times when I have preached at my church, you know, like, a lot of times that spirit comes on me, and I'm trying to fight it on bringing the word, I'm like, man, what's up with this? You know, and like, yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. Now you and your wife is keeping your bedroom holy. You know what I'm talking about. You're keeping your bedroom holy.
Yes.
Okay, that's great. So in other words, Marcus, it's just an attack. It's an attack for them, and we all have gone through that, or is going through that. I remember when I first started ministering for the Lord, how the devil would attack me. You know, God had opened the door
yes.
where this ministry has given me the fifth Sunday every month to minister the children's might on our local television station, and for about 30 minutes. And,
yes.
and I would do that. But every time I would do it, I would get such an attack. I mean, a tremendous attack. And then the Lord revealed to me why I was getting those attacks. What I did not know at that moment, that in our little small town, there was a witch coven. And that witch coven was probably not about 2 or 3 blocks away from the house. And the Lord told me that this witch coven, they would get together on a certain night, especially when the Christian programming come on, and they would turn to the Christian station. And they would throw curses and spells and hex. Because I remember when I would look through the camera, like, this bright light would just pierce through my eyes and just like it was cutting my eyes. And I said, oh, Lord, I can't stand this. And the Lord would always tell me, ignore it. The Lord didn't take it away. He was teaching me. He was teaching me to stand in knowing that he takes care of me. Okay.
Right.
Now this thing that comes upon you, does it mostly happen when you stand before people to minister, or does it happen all the time?
I mean, it doesn't happen 24/7, but I know a lot of times it happens like when I stand for people. Sometimes it does, like in certain situations. You know what I'm saying? Like I mean, it's like it just comes out. Sometimes it could be like when I'm at work, it comes out of blue sometimes, and then I don't know what triggers it, but it doesn't happen 24/7. That is though.
When I say all the time, I'm not talking about 24/7. I mean it happened other places than on the pulpit when you're on the pulpit.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Where that is an attack. That's an attack. We're gonna get outward attacks. That's the enemy trying to get back in. And it figure if it keeps on attacking you long enough, that you will believe that spirit is in you. When that spirit is not in you, it wants to come back into you. Okay.
Right.
And also remember now, Marcus, whenever you stand in the pulpit, there's a lot of women out there who are not godly women. They say they are, but they're not. But when they look at you ministering, they saying to themselves, I want a man like that. And they are,
that's what my wife had kind of shared with me about something like that, you know, about, you know, how women won't, because, you know, you is,
And they will target you. So those spirits, those spirits in them, as they watch you, that spirit of lust in them, that snake spirit in them, in other words, what they don't realize they're doing, they are throwing it at you. And that is a type of witchcraft. That type of witchcraft. But you got to stand in your most holy faith in God and knowing that those weapons that are formed, they cannot prosper against you. Your aim is to minister the word of God. That is your aim. You know, don't when you minister, you know, just don't look at the people. You know, just look around them. Until you get strong enough to be able to look straight at them and regardless of what the enemy does, you know, it just don't affect you. So you got to stand in your most holy faith. This is a warfare. This is a battle. Those spirits are not in you. They're trying to get back into you, but they're trying to wear you down where you will think that they are in you when they are not. And even when you're not even in the pulpit, you know, women come your way, you got to just look beyond them. You know, you have a work to do, and you're going to have to overcome this. You know, God's not going to move that out of the way. He's not. Because as a man of God, you got to be able to minister to women just like you minister to men. Because God have women, Satan got them so bound, there may be a woman that comes up to you in the nude. But you ain't looking at her body. You're looking at her soul. You're looking at her soul. The body is, God wants to raise you up to the point that when you see this woman, you don't even see a naked body. You see her soul. You know, I'm reminded, I can't think who this man of God was, but it was his first time going to Africa, the port where they got people where really, they really not civilized as they should. They still addressing their tradition. And he said the moment he got off the plane, the people lined up to welcome him. And he said when he got to the line, he saw nothing but women breasts. See, showing the breasts to them was nothing. It was nothing to them because that was their traditional way of dressing. But see, if he was not mature, spiritually mature in Christ Jesus, he would have succumbed to lust when he saw those women breasts. But he didn't see women breasts. He saw a soul. So God wants to raise up your faith. Again, he's not going to move all of that. He wants to raise your faith up. Because, again, I'm telling you, there are going to be women who are going to come in skimpy outfits, and they can come running to the altar because their eyes is on Jesus. And so when they run to the altar, their eyes on Jesus, your eyes will be on Jesus. Your eyes won't be on them, on their body. No, your eyes is on Jesus. I mean, Jesus had given you the perfect example. Could you imagine the temptations that he endured, that he went through? The temptation, the scripture said there's no temptation that we have gone through that you have not already gone through. So these temptations and tests that you're going through, Jesus already went through it and he has already overcome. So you walk in his victory. Because again, God got people out there that's hurting that really need him, and that includes women. He's going to send in prostitutes. You know, when prostitutes come to the Lord, they're coming as they are. They ain't getting all
right.
messed up. They come as they are. So you're going to, so as a man of God, a minister of the gospel, you're going to have to, again, overlook that. You ain't looking at their body. You're looking at their soul. And you say, come on here, sister, the other men in your church, they're gonna not going to be at your level, and they're going to be in love. And they're going to wonder how he can do that, you know, because you have overcome those things through Christ Jesus, and because you're looking at that person's soul. See, that's why I'm able to minister to women and men, because I told the Lord, I said, Lord, I do not want a ministry where I just minister to women. That is not right. Jesus ministers to mankind. He looks at
yep.
souls. So that's the reason why I can minister to whoever God sent. It don't matter if you're a man. It don't matter what age you are. You can be my age, a little young, a little old. It don't matter. I look at a soul. I look at you as a soul. And that's how God wants to raise you, Marcus. Okay? Because, again, he said he's not going to remove that temptation. He wants you to know that those spirits are not in you. They just want to come back. They want to come back. And your wife was right. Well, again, in that church where you go to, there's lonely women. Lord said they were lonely women, and they just longing for a man just like you, even though they're not even like you, but they want a man like you. So that spirit of lust in them, when they look at you, that is lust. And that's actually what you're feeling. That's, thank you, Jesus. Lord said that's what you're feeling. You're feeling the lust that's coming from them because they're throwing those spirits at you because that's the spirits that are in them. So what you do every time before you go to minister, you need to bind those spirits. They're not going to understand what you're doing, and you don't worry about that. They want to come later and ask you, why did you do that, Marcus? You tell them, we have to bind the works of the devil. Bind his words. Say it out loud. Don't be saying it to yourself. You take authority in Jesus' name, and you bind those filthy spirits. They are filthy spirits. You bind them in Jesus' name. And then you loose the Holy Spirit to minister as a father has given him to minister. And then you go on and do what God wants you to do.
Amen. I got one other question. Just a question. I need your wisdom on. I've been dealing with this thing where I've been, you know, been moving from job to job, and a lot of it has not to do with me personally, just of the area or of the kind of jobs, and I've been praying about God, why do I keep moving from job to job, and I never can't seem to land a job that I want. I mean, I've been praying to God about this specific career that I want to move into, but because of certain things, it seems like I never can walk into it and be able to provide for my family in the way that, you know, that I want. I mean, I'm working now, obviously, but it's just the fact that it's like I never can walk into the career that will allow me to make a little bit more money. You know what I'm saying? The better. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Well, this is what I did when I was in that predicament. I thought about where I wanted to work. I thought about how much I wanted to be paid. And then what I started doing, I started thanking God each and every day for that particular job and for that amount of pay. At the
right.
same time, I could tend to be in other positions, but I kept thanking God for the position I really want to be in, the work that I really want to do, and for that amount of pay. I kept thanking him, praising him, exalting him. Each and every day, I kept doing that. And then, lo and behold, eventually, it came to pass. And that's,
right.
that's what you have to do. You continue
okay.
to do the same thing. Just be where you are. Just be content and be faithful to where you are, and then at the same time, thank God for the job that you really want to do and the amount of pay you really want to make. You start thanking and praising for it, and before you know it, an opportunity is going to open up, and that door will open. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Amen. All right, Brother Marcus, you continue to hang in there and continue to love your wife as Christ Jesus loved the church and your plans and purposes, idea for the Lord, it shall be fulfilled in his mighty name. Okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Praise God. Okay, so I have 2411. I'm going to bring you on. All right, 2411. You calling in for a session?
Hello. Hi.
Yeah. Hi. What's your first name and the state you calling from?
I'm calling from Virginia. My name is Liz.
Liz from Virginia. How did you find out about me? About me, Liz.
My friend Gwen.
Okay. Did I minister to Gwen, or she just found me on YouTube?
What did you say?
Did I ever minister to Gwen, or she just found me on YouTube?
I think you talked to Gwen on Facebook before, and I talked to you on Facebook before, too. I talked to you last night.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I talked to you, and you told me that you were going to have a session on Friday, too, because I was holding on the line yesterday, but I think I called the wrong number.
Okay, so your Facebook name is not Liz.
It's Elizabeth.
Okay. I remember you now. Okay. You now. Okay.
How you doing?
Right. I'm fine. Okay. What is it you expecting from God today, Elizabeth?
For deliverance in my mind.
Your mind. Well,
yes.
Well, what's going on? Tell exactly now. Confess to what's going on and what you have been going through and been experiencing.
Okay. Well, the worst of it started last year, and I was going to see this natural doctor, and it was like I started thinking about her all the time and having these really obsessive thoughts about her, and I couldn't get them out of my mind, and I would just think about her all the time, like 24/7. And at first I didn't think there was anything wrong with it because she was like my mentor, and I really looked up to her, and she would pray for me when I would come to her office and stuff. So I just thought that, you know, I really liked her, you know. But then when I tried to think of other things, I noticed I couldn't turn those thoughts off. And it just took over my mind, basically. And then I ended up in the mental health hospital. And when I got out of the hospital, I dealt with paranoia maybe for about 3 months, 3 or 4 months, and then that subsided. And then after that, I went through this period where I would go out in public and people's faces would get stuck in my mind, like I couldn't get their face out of my mind. And I'd have to pray in the spirit for like an hour to get those pictures out of my mind. And then my pastor prayed for me, and that went away, and it never came back. And then it switched back to me thinking about the natural doctor a lot. And then it would just be like I would have these really depressing thoughts or, like, suicidal thoughts or I even went through this period where I had all these really vile thoughts, like really vile sexual thoughts that would come to my mind, and it's just been – it's just been one thing after another, and it seemed like it just got worse over this past year, and it's like I just can't get any peace. And I'll pray, and sometimes it'll go away, and then it'll just come back. Or people will pray with me, and then it will go away for a little while, and then it'll just come back. I can't get rid of it.
Okay. Did you ever visit a psychic? A place
did what?
With a psychic?
No, ma'am.
How about a Ouija board? You ever been on a Ouija board, play with the Ouija board when you're a little girl?
No, we used to play this game where we would try to levitate.
Yeah, yeah.
And you'll say light as a feather, stiff as a board, and try to levitate. I remember playing that game before as a child.
Yeah, that's witchcraft. That's still like playing a Ouija, playing with the Ouija board's witchcraft. You are connected to that witchcraft covenant. Now you play with other little children.
Yeah.
Well, how do you all know about this game?
I don't even know. And we used to look in the mirror and say Bloody Mary when I was growing up and turn off the light.
Witchcraft. Have your parents ever mentioned anything about witchcraft in your family lineage? Someone purposely delved into witchcraft?
Not that I know of.
Yeah. Someone delved into witchcraft. There were witchcraft workers in your family lineage, because kids just don't pick up games like that. Now, that house that you lived in, that you played that game as a little girl, did you ever see any type of paranormal activity? Shadows, figures.
We saw. I don't know if it was an intruder in our home or if it was a spirit, but it just looked like a white face with, like, black hair. And my mom said that she experienced, my brother was watching this movie called Pet Cemetery, and she said that she saw, like, a cat-like figure, maybe, like, 6 feet tall. She said it came in through the window and stepped on her back and walked back towards my brother's room.
Yeah, someone in your family lineage, your parent, your grandparents, down that line, was heavily involved in witchcraft. Now, is did you live with both your mother and your father, or just your mother?
Both my parents.
Okay, are they still alive?
Yeah. I see them every day almost. Well, I see them a lot.
Yeah. After your deliverance, you need to talk to them about who was it that was involved in witchcraft. Your parent, your grandparent, your great grandparent, someone was involved in witchcraft. And whenever a person involves themselves in witchcraft, they just don't give Satan their soul, they give Satan their seeds as well. And so
give Satan what?
Their seed.
Okay.
Seed. That means their offspring, their children, the ones that are there and ones that are not even born yet. Satan wants to see, and that's what you are dealing. That's what you are dealing with today.
My mom said that she went through something in her mind for a long time too. So she went through something similar like what I'm going through.
Yeah. So if your mom went through it, so it gets to your great grandparents somewhere down the line. Your parent, your great grandparents, your great great grandparents. I don't know how far back. But someone purposely and willingly delved into witchcraft. And again, by doing so, they promised Satan their seed. And that's why their children, which is their offspring, is going through what they're going through. And that's also why you've been attacked with mental spirits, spirit of lust. And then there's a spirit husband and there's a spirit wife there, you know, that lesbian spirit as well. But the most important thing, Liz, is your obedience to God now. You know, are you doing everything in your power to be obedient to God? There's no open doors of disobedience.
Yes.
Because if there's open doors of disobedience, they give these spirit legal rights to stay. They stand in their house. They claim in you as their house, and they will stay if there's open doors of disobedience.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So are you in obedience to God?
I believe that I am. I was overeating, but I've been getting control over that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, is there any type of, if you're not married, is there any type of relationship?
No.
Okay. Stay in obedience to God. So what I'm going to do, now where are you now?
I'm in my car.
You're in your car? You parked somewhere in your car?
I'm parked outside of a farmer's market.
Okay. So where you park, are there people going about where they can look and see what you're doing?
I see two people here. They're walking towards their car.
Okay. I need for you to go in a place where you know, people won't be so easily to come up to and distract you.
Okay.
And for those, now, I'm saying this for those who are going to tune into this over the archives. When you call me, dear heart, make sure it's best that you be in your home, right there alone in your home without distraction. Because if there are distractions, Satan will use those distractions to hinder your deliverance. So don't call if you're in a car. Wait till you get home by yourself away from distractions. So I'm going to give you time, Liz, to pull away where there's no distraction. Okay.
Okay, that's what I'm doing now.
All right. Yes, because that's very important. Because Satan, again, will use distractions to hinder your deliverance. So that's why it's just best to just be in your home where it's just you. That way you can truly focus on what God is about to do, and you would not have those distractions. Because I remember one deliverance where I had one of my team members to do a deliverance, and the deliverance wasn't completed. And it really puzzled her because she asked me to listen to it. And when I did, I saw just perfectly how Satan stopped that deliverance. The woman was seeking deliverance, but her mother, who was still tied to that ungodly witchcraft covenant, because witchcraft was in her family lineage, those demons in her mother heard and knew that her daughter was getting delivered, and all of a sudden you could hear her in the background yelling and fussing. And she was doing it in her language, but she was fussing at what was going on. And that served as a distraction. And next thing you know, the woman said, I got to call you back. And she hung up the phone. And to this day, she never got delivered.
Whoa.
She's on Facebook posting the word of God. And she posting pictures of herself, you know, in provocative ways. And she called herself a woman of God. And she never got delivered because the demon through her mother stopped. Never got enough. So that's why I tell you, you know, just make sure you be in a place where it's only you and away from distractions. Okay.
I'm stuck at the light right now. I'm about to turn into a neighborhood.
Okay.
Really quick.
All right then.
So I'm waiting at the light. But
right.
I do. Yeah, what you said about the spirit husband and the spirit wife is true because I remember when I was a teenager. I didn't know it was a spirit. I just thought it was a regular dream. But I had a dream. I had like a sexual dream about this girl who was on my track team. And I just woke up really feeling really weird, you know. And I guess that's probably where all that spirit started, just from having that dream like that. And
No, but that's not where it originated. That it entered you through when you were a child. When you was playing all those demonic games, that's how those spirits and when those spirits enter you, and they've been there the whole while, and they only manifested to you through the dream. If they would have manifested through you in the physical, then you would have knew for sure that they were there. But because they come through the dream, you think, well, that's just a dream, and you wouldn't count it as them being in you because you're too busy looking at it as being a dream. When in truth, those spirits have always been there because of being still attached to that ungodly covenant. See, when you first came to Jesus Christ, no one asked you really. Liz carried you through a deliverance. Now, they may have prayed for you, but they did not confront the stronghold in your life and trusted God's word in decreeing on earth for you to be totally free and for them to come out. No one ever did that, and that's the reason why they had always been there in that house. But praise be to God. God is so gracious and merciful. He refused to allow us to remain as we are because he wants to have a deeper walk and relationship with him. He wants us totally free. He's not going to coexist with demons. There are some people, they may want to coexist with them, but God is not going to do that. So God wants you totally free. You've been pursuing him. And God has heard you, he has answered you, and he wants to clean you completely up so that you can truthfully worship him spiritually. Praise his holy name.
Okay, I'm in a neighborhood right now. There's not anybody out. It's just a bunch of cars on the street.
Okay, that's great. All right, so
okay.
We go ahead and pause, and we thank you, Father, for setting angels around her and letting the neighbors tend to their business. As you tend to your business, and so that they don't think that she's up to something. But Father, we just thank you for shielding her and protecting her for this moment. So Liz, I'm going to go ahead and pray for you, and by faith, I'm going to speak this disconnection. So, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you again for this opportunity to minister your love, Father, to Liz, your grace and your mercy. I thank you, Father, that it's Liz's time now to shine forth, to go strong in your glory and bring in glory and honor only to Jesus Christ. Because every plan and purpose and idea that you have already ordained to take place in her life on earth and bring in only glory to your son, Jesus Christ, it shall be fulfilled in and through her. Father, I thank you for cleaning up your house this day for true worship, Father. Thank you, Father, for removing and rearranging things in your house, Father. Taking out things that shouldn't be there. Putting things in that should be there, Father. You decorate your house the way that you desire to decorate your house, Father, and we give you praise and glory. And I ask you to give Liz more understanding and revelation of who she is only in your son, Jesus, and also who Jesus is in her. I thank you, Father, that every door that the enemy have closed off to Liz, and it was your will for those doors to be opened by faith on this earth, Father, I open those doors. And those doors that the enemy, Father, has opened and it's not your will to be opened, I also close those doors, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. I thank you, Father, that every plan, purpose, and idea shall come to pass. And I thank you for keeping her, Father, rinsing her, cleaning her by your word, by your wisdom, by your knowledge, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. And we thank you for your presence, because you said when two or three of us come together in your son's name, you are right here with us, and whatever we bind and loose on this earth, Father, you bind and you loose into heaven. So I'm taking authority in Jesus' mighty name. And I command you, spirit, husband, and witchcraft, come to attention in Jesus' name and pack your loads and get out of God's house. Get out in Jesus' name. For the blood of Jesus has forgiven her and her ancestors. The blood of Jesus set her free and her ancestors. The blood of Jesus nullifies every covenant and contract known and unknown to her and her parent and her grandparent in Jesus' mighty name. The blood of Jesus set her free, and you have no legal right to remain in her. You come out of her mind. Come out of her mind. Pack your load and come out of her mind. You come out of her will. You come out of her emotions. You come out of her dreams, come out of her dreams, you come out of her visions, and you come out of her body in Jesus' mighty name, in Jesus Christ's mighty name, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, his mighty name, you come out in Jesus' name. Holy Ghost fire, Holy Ghost fire, Holy Ghost fire, Holy Ghost fire, celebrate. Search and destroy darkness that lurking and hiding dormantly in her will. Burn by your mighty fire. Saturate her will by your fire. Burn every spirit in her will that have exalted itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn in Jesus' name. Continue to consume darkness that's in her mind. Burn, Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost fire, burn every spirit in her mind that has exalted and lifted itself against God's knowledge. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn, Holy Ghost. Set her mind completely ablaze by your mighty fire. Burn, rinse, and purify her mind by your fire in Jesus' mighty name. Continue to even burn in her emotions. Set her emotions completely ablaze. Search and destroy all darkness in her emotions that has exalted itself and lifts itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn in her emotions. Burn every feeling in her emotion that is not of you. Every false feeling that is not of you. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn, burn in her emotion. Set her emotion completely ablaze by your mighty fire. Continue to burn even in her body. Purify her body by your fire. Ransack her body. by your mighty fire. Burn, Holy Ghost, burn in her eyes. Burn in her eyes. Burn darkness that have accumulated in her eyes. Burn, Holy Ghost, don't leave no area in her eyes untouched. Burn by your mighty fire. Burn in her nostrils. Burn in her mouth, down her throat. Burn in her belly. Burn all manner of spirits in her belly that are dormantly hiding and hatching in her belly. Don't leave no area untouched in her belly. Burn in her uterus. Burn in her fallopian tube. Burn in her womb. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn in her private parts. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn up and down her legs and her arms. Burn her fingers and her feet and her toes. Burn every jewelry that's been placed on her body. Burn every object that's been placed in her body. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn, burn, burn. Don't leave no area untouched. Untouched, ransack her body from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet by your mighty fire. Purify her body in Jesus' mighty name. By faith, I take God's scissors in the spirit realm. I cut and detach her from the ungodly covenant of family of adoption witchcraft. For the blood of Jesus detached her. The blood of Jesus disconnected her. The blood of Jesus severed at the root that connection in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name, I detach her and disconnect her from that evil spirit marriage, evil spirit man, spirit wife, spirit husband, spirit woman, spirit children, spirit family. I disconnect her by faith from every relationship in the spirit realm that the Father did not connect her to. I disconnect in Jesus' mighty name, even in the natural realm. Every relationship the Father did not connect her to, I disconnect those relationships by the blood of Jesus. I sever those relationships by the blood of Jesus. For the blood of Jesus set her totally free. The blood of Jesus ransomed, purchased her, paid for her in full. The blood of Jesus was shed for her. The blood of Jesus has forgiven her of her transgressions. The blood of Jesus has forgiven her of her iniquities. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus severed all ungodly covenants and contracts. The blood of Jesus destroys all wickedness. The blood of Jesus destroys all wickedness from the very beginning, even until the end. The blood of Jesus set her totally free. Live in Jesus' name. Be totally free in your mind. Be free in your mind. Be free in your mind. Be free in your will. Be free in your emotions. Be free in your dreams. Be free in your vision. And be totally free in your body to serve and worship the Lord thy God. In him only will you serve in spirit and truth. Be free in Jesus' mighty name. Be free. Be free in Jesus' name. Father, fill Liz to overflow with your spirit. Fill her, Father. Fill her mind. Fill her mind with your spirit. Fill her will with your spirit. Fill her emotions with your spirit. Fill her dreams. Fill her vision with your spirit. And fill her body, Father, with your spirit in Jesus' mighty name. Father, I also pray for Liz House and for her all her property. Holy Ghost fire, go at Liz House, even in her car, in all her property. Touch and destroy darkness by your fire. Holy Ghost fire, set ablaze all her property. Go under every bed, under every chair and couch. Burn, burn by your fire. Go around the bed, under the bed, over the bed, between the sheets and the mattress, even in her car, under the car seat, over the car seat. Don't leave no air, even in her car, untouched, and in her house. Go in every corner, crack, and crevice of her property and destroy darkness. Find every hiding place of darkness and scorch and burn and incinerate by your mighty fire. Even go outside of her house, burn around the house, under the house, even under the ground. Underground when she was little, things were planted. Even up to now, burn those evil objects. Burn those evil objects in the oceans. Burn those evil objects in the waters. Burn those evil objects. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn the papers that it was written on, the pen that it was written with. Burn by your mighty fire. Set it completely ablaze by your fire in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, for cleansing and purifying your house for true worship, Father. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. You are free, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, you are free. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Liz?
Hello?
You are free. You are free in Jesus' mighty name. You are free.
Amen.
You're free. You're free.
Amen.
So just thank him because you are free.
Thanks, Lord.
Amen. You are totally free in Jesus' name. So as I was praying, what was going on with you as I was praying?
I was feeling the Holy Spirit in my body, like shaking my body. And then I could feel some things going on in my mind, like a little prickly feeling in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
And right now I feel pretty lightheaded.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. It's done in Jesus' name. It's done in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Glory, glory, glory. So your mind, how do your mind feel? Because that's where there was really, really strong in your mind.
Yeah, that's why I think I feel lightheaded.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So.
All right.
I'm being healed of bipolar disorder.
Mm-hmm.
And I had like a demon. It was a depression demon. And I prayed maybe about a month and a half ago. I have been cursing myself in my mind. And I renounced those curses, and that spirit came out of my mind, and I felt it leave.
Mm-hmm.
I felt very lightheaded.
Well, you are totally free.
Now, no, I wonder, there's still more.
No. They are not. No, see, that's how demons deceive people. See, God is good. Do you think God would deliver you of one demon and leave the rest in you, Liz?
No, I'm saying at that moment, I wasn't totally free.
Okay. Remember what I'm saying, because demons are sneaky. They would tell you, yes, such and such demon is gone, but such and such is still here. They are liars. They are liars. Jesus don't do work like that. He don't deliver you from one demon and leave several more in you to come out later. No, we wouldn't do our own children like that. Why do we think God would do us like that? No. God deliver us from them all. They all go. Lord said, unless you bind a strong man, you cannot spoil his good. Now, let me ask you, are you taking any depressant medication? Because such medication will keep the door open for demons to come back into you, because you're not dependent on the Holy Ghost. He's your comforter. He's your comforter. We cannot depend on what man made to give us comfort when the Holy Ghost is our true and only comfort. The Lord don't give us a mind that is mental. That comes from the inner. But the Lord give us a sound mind. That's the mind that God gives us. And we need to start claiming the mind that God gives us. And how we do that, we speak it out of our mouth, so that as we continue to hear God's word, it builds faith in our heart. So again, if you're taking such drugs to help your mind, it's never going to help your mind. That's going to keep the door open for these demon spirits. You got to trust God. You are set totally free. And regardless of how the enemy comes back and try to tell you you're going to go crazy unless you take that medication, you need to rebuke it and continue to keep your mind stayed on God. Parents have messed up. these past 20 to 30 years, because I remember when they start giving kids these drugs, because they first started experimentation, they started with Project Mom. I remember that. I was a young teenager myself, and they started out with that stuff. And there was a, especially started out mainly with the boys, if it seemed to be like they had a difficult time in being obedient. That's because the parents, you know, was demonized, so the child was demonized. So social service thought that they can take care of a spiritual problem with something physical. So Satan gave them the idea to start giving these kids this drug. 20 years later, now they are hooked on those drugs, and they are and they are just mentally off. They are mentally off. So
I feel very lightheaded, almost like I could pass out.
You're not going to pass out. You got, remember now, those spirits had your mind. They had your mind, and they had to go. So you're going to feel that lightheadedness. So what you need to do, even after I hang up the phone, don't drive yet. Just say, Jesus, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for delivering me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me your strength. You need to meditate on the things of God. You need to open your mouth and speak the things of God. Then as you do that, then your strength will start coming to you. Now you see why I tell people when you have to take deliverance serious. You just can't be anywhere, you know, and then call a number to get delivered. Now if you call somebody number who actually is not a true servant of God and they do deliver, well, them devils ain't going nowhere no way. So you able to do whatever you can do, because the devil is still in you. But when you go to a true servant of God, those demons are coming out. So when they come out, see, this is a spiritual battle, spiritual warfare. So when they come out, remember this human flesh, we only can take so much. It ties the body out. So it's best to be at home in a place. So after you're delivered, you can just lay there and rest, because your body just went through a spiritual battle. Just like in the natural with soldiers in the army, when they go through that physical battle, after that battle, they got to go somewhere and rest because their body is tired out. Same thing spiritually. So for those of you who are listening now or maybe listening to archive, that's what you do. You wait till you get home, because remember, this is a spiritual warfare. It's not a game. It's just not a game. You have to take it seriously. We actually is fighting in a war that is not seen with your flesh and blood eyes. So those demons, they come out. And see, your body felt that battle. And that's why come you. You feeling that way because that your mind was the main area in which those demons was really had taken up residence, was really residing in. So that's why you feel that weakness. So again, you know, after you hang up, don't dry. Just wait a little bit. It'd been great if you had some water there so you can sip on some water to replenish your body.
I have something to drink. I have something that I can drink.
Yes.
I do have a question for you.
Uh-huh.
If you're, like I said, my mind would kind of obsess over people. It did in the past. It's not going to do that anymore because I'm set free.
Right.
And
right.
I believe that. Do you think that, I know that was a spirit driving that and that it had nothing to do with the person really. So do you have to, like, stop talking to that person, or
no, okay. No, because it was a spirit. It was that spirit in you that really was suggesting. See, when demon spirits are in you, see, first of all, demons are personalities. That's their personality. So when they are in you, that's what you feel. You feel their personality. So it was that demon expressing its personality towards the woman. Now, that woman do need to be delivered herself. She needs to be delivered as well, because you don't know what the same demon in her was telling her. Now, that's something that you won't never know. But, no, you don't have to stop talking to a person. You just pray for them and trust God that the same way that God delivered you, that he would deliver them. You know, ask the Lord to send her to the human helper that he has chosen to send her to. You pray for her, and then anybody else as well, you pray for them. It doesn't mean that you know, you don't go see her, because she do have an expertise, a gift that God has given her, okay? But But this time when you go back, if what she say is not what Jesus Christ would say, then that's when you disconnect. That's when you have to disconnect then. Because you want to only be around those who say what Jesus say. You know, if they don't say what Jesus say, then you cannot fellowship with them. You have to disconnect. But you are totally free, Liz. So just make sure you just stay in obedience to God. You know, stay in the Word. You need to build your mind in Christ Jesus. The only way that you can build up your mind is when you meditate on the Word of God.
I've been doing that. That's one thing I was quoting that scripture, taking every thought, casting down every every high. That one I can't say it right now, but I was taking that scripture.
Get the Bible, the Holy Bible, in your hand, and just meditate and study over His Word. Don't be going on the internet and listen to this minister and that minister what they have to say, because the devil gonna bring in confusion. Mess up your mind. That's what mess up a lot of God's children's mind. They go on the internet, especially YouTube, and listen to this person and that person and this person, and they don't know what is the truth because they listen to something everywhere. You know, if God has showed you one or two or three people that truly, when they minister, they point you straight to Jesus Christ, they only mess with God's Word, then stick with them, with those one, two, or three people. Don't be going exploring other places, because it's going to bring in confusion. You're going to bring in confusion. I mean, that's what I did, and I thank God for telling me to do that, which I didn't understand why He told me, but now I understand, and I said, Lord, thank You, because I would have gotten so confused. So that's what you need to do, because your mind got to be strengthened in the things of God. Okay?
Okay.
And also, since you follow me on my Facebook, I posted a video early this morning from another ministry, this deliverance session where this minister was casting out some spirits, this young boy in Zimbabwe, and it was the things that the demon was doing and confessing to about the women wearing false hair, false nails, false
teeth. I don't have anything false. I got an afro.
Just listen to it. Okay, and watch, and then Lord gonna show you something. And not only that, the clothes too. You know, that certain clothes that belongs to the enemy. Because I know the women who do have their hair. Well, they boldly say, "Well, I don't wear false. I got false. I got my hair." I said, "Well, that's good and well, but something else is there." So you just listen to the Holy Spirit. Always keep an open heart and mind to listen to the Holy Spirit. We may be obedient to God in one area, but we may not be in another area. And we won't find that out unless we are open to the Holy Spirit talking to us. So just listen to that video. I don't be placing videos up there just to be placing. You know, you need to take time out and listen, because the Holy Spirit is talking to us this day, because time is soon going to end. Okay? So you continue to stay blessed, Liz, okay?
God bless you. Thank you very much. I'll be praying for you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Just sit there for a little while and sit and sip on something to gain your strength, and then you can drive off, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
All right, then. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Praise God. Let me see who next. I have many other callers. Let me see here. I see 7053 returned from yesterday, but it looks like I have an international caller. So 7053, I'm going to pick up on this international call, and after this international call, then I will bring you on, okay? Because on the international call, they really have to pay so much cost to come online. All right, let me see here. All right, okay. This is 6119 international call. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Brian.
Brian,
and
what country you calling from?
From Mexico.
Are you from Mexico?
Yeah.
Now, Brian, have I messaged you before?
Yes. I called like 2 months ago.
Okay. You know what? I've been waiting for you. I was waiting for you to call me back because we got disconnected.
Yeah. That was really frustrating.
Did you happen to listen to your deliverance session on my YouTube?
Yeah, I
left you a message.
Yes, a few days later, I start to search in the Holy Ghost Radio. I see the recordings of that day, and I hear it.
Good. Thank you. Now you heard what I said.
Yeah.
As far as you've gotten delivered.
Yeah. I have the same trouble. I don't know.
Because God delivered you, but the enemy was going to use us being disconnected to his advantage and telling you that you did not get delivered because we were disconnected.
Yeah.
And that was not true, Brian. That was not true.
Uh-huh.
Because even though me and you in the physical were disconnected, but in the spirit, I was not disconnected from them demons. Them demons were hearing those fire prayers because there's no distance in the spirit realm.
Yeah, that's right.
Because the Lord told me to carry on. He said, continue to cast those spirits out of him. And those spirits left. But the Lord told me that they would try their best to get you to believe that you were not delivered all because you didn't hear that conversation. When the conversation wasn't for you anyway.
Uh-huh.
That conversation was to those demons, and you really didn't need to hear that. So tell me what happened, or what you experienced, or what happened after we got disconnected. What did you do?
Well, some days later, I stopped to having that dreams, but I think maybe, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 days. But then they started again. In the dreams is the same dream. It's this woman becoming a beautiful lady.
Mm-hmm. Now let me ask you this. When it happened the first time you dreamed it, what did you do after you woke up? What did you do and what did you say?
Well, in the dream, it's a little bit weird because that I know her, and it's like someone familiar to me. But if she is very close to me, it's like I can resist her. But
okay.
Let
me ask the question another way.
Uh-huh.
After you've had that dream again, seeing the lady in the dream,
uh-huh,
did you believe that spirit was still in you because you saw her in that dream?
Yes, because she want to do the same thing.
Where you messed up. That's what I was trying to tell you.
Uh-huh.
You were delivered. See, we need to realize that whatever God does for us, Brian, we must receive by faith in his word.
Okay.
It don't matter what we dream.
Mm-hmm.
Your evidence, Brian, that God set you free is not in what you dream or what you do not dream.
Uh-huh.
Your evidence that God set you free is your faith in his word.
Okay.
Okay. So when the devil sent that demon to look like this woman that you know in your dream, what you should have did when you woke up, first of all, you should have rebuked that lie. That lying dream, that was a lie from the enemy, because he sent it so that you can think that since you dreamed, that means that spirit is still in you. But that's a lie. That's a lie. So you should have rebuked it, and then you should have turned around and thanked God for delivering you. And no more thought about that dream, and no more talked about that dream. But continue to praise and thank God for delivering you. And as you to continue to thank God for delivering you, that is a way of magnifying him. And you know, whenever you magnify something, you make it bigger and bigger and bigger. And Jesus became so big in your life, you would have forgotten about that dream.
Yeah.
So what you're going to have to do, you're going to have to stop believing your dream, especially after your deliverance. Now, before your deliverance, it was a different thing. That spirit was in you before your deliverance. But after your deliverance, it was no longer in you. But it wanted to come back. And that's how it would enter back, is through the dream, because you believe that it's in you when you dream. We got to believe God's word. Our faith is in his word. The scripture said whatever is not of faith, Brian, that is sin. Sin will open the door for the enemy to come back into us. Okay? So you got to receive what God do for you by faith only in his word. Again, it don't make no difference what you dream. What you dream do not dictate to you what you believe in God. No. And I noticed that. I know a lot of people think just because they dream something, it's true. It's true, they dream. But someone else can dream the very same thing, and they don't believe their dream, but they believe their own dreams. No, Satan will give you dreams. Not all the 99.9% of dreams, Brian, is not from God. It's not from God. If Satan cannot get you to be with a woman in the natural realm, he would get you to be with one in your dreams. In your dreams. And that's where, again, after you deliver it, you have to rebuke those dreams. Every now and then I would have such dreams because of my ministry and casting these devils out. Every now and then they throw such dreams, give me such dreams. So when I wake up, I rebuke those dreams, and then I thank God for his deliverance, and I magnify him. And then next thing you know, I don't even remember what the dream was about. And see, that's what we have to do. It's a fight.
Yeah, because it always is in midnight and and I have a little child from 1 year and a half. And suddenly I woke up and he starts to cry and he said no, and you know, I felt that this is this evil spirit trying to attack us. But every night I always cover me and my family with the blood of Jesus.
Good, great. That's what you do. And put your hands on your child and pray and thank God for sweet sleep. Because my oldest daughter was 10 years old. I didn't know she was having problems sleeping, and until she confessed it to me. And then the Lord told me, he said, Terry, he said, you need to take your anointing on and anoint her head every night before she go to bed, because she's getting attacked by demon spirit. Because at that moment, the house that we live in, that house, it wasn't our house. And that house was demonized. We were living with our parents temporarily, and that house was demonized. So since the house didn't belong to us, we did not have authority to cast those demons out of that house, because that wasn't our house. So the Lord told me to anoint her head with anointing oil every night before she goes to sleep. And he said by doing so, that would give her peaceful sleep. And so I started doing that, Brian, and then every morning I wake up, I said, how do you see how? Oh, Mom, I slept great. It was great. It was good. Then I remember it went on for a few days, and one night I just totally forgot, and I was asleep around midnight, and it's like the Lord woke me up. And I said, oh, Lord. And she went downstairs to where my parents, and I was upstairs. And Lord said, Terry, you forgot anoint Helen's head. I said, Lord, I sure did, but I am so sleepy, I can't get up. I said, Lord, could you send an angel to anoint Helen's head? And I went right on back to sleep. And that's what I said. I said, could you send an angel to anoint Helen's head? And I fell asleep. So I woke up next morning, Brian, and my little 10-year-old just came in the room all happy and jolly. And I said, that's right, I forgot to anoint her head. I said, Helen, how you sleep last night? Well, Mama, at first, because, you know, you forgot to come and anoint my head, And I started having bad dreams. And then all of a sudden, you came in the room. And you said, oh, Helen, I forgot to anoint your head. And you anointed my head. And when you did, I fell asleep. she told me that. And when she told me that, Brian, I said, oh, Lord, thank you. Because I did ask you to send an angel. And he sent the angel to look just like me. Because Helen knew me as a mom. And she wouldn't have been fearful.
Mm-hmm.
I said, Helen, baby, I said, Mommy forgot. Mommy asked the Lord to send an angel, and that was the angel knocking in your head. She said, Mama, I slept all night. So that's what you have to do to your children as well as your wife.
Yeah, and now, I see it. And even 2 days ago, I start to feel like an attack. I feel like...
Yeah, you were being attacked because you are the head of the house. Also, you want me to tell you, Brian,
but I feel something precious because it was like something in front of me like a shield, but I feel like a peace, and it's like if I move my hand between this shield and the other side, I feel that this evil attack cannot attack me.
That's right, Brian.
Huh?
I said, that's right. They cannot because of the angels.
Yeah, and I feel like the protection of the Lord and a little bit because it was like, want to attack me. But this shield or power doesn't allow that attack, and it feels like peace. And I was like not totally asleep, but almost. And I want to get asleep. I don't pray. I thank the Lord in my heart for the protection. I fall asleep.
Amen.
I start to pray and surrender my life to Jesus and ask if I need to give it to him some area of my life, and then I see your faith. I say, Lord, do you want me to do something? And was praying when I saw your faith. I said, Lord, you want I call back my sister Ted. I feel that I needed to call.
Amen.
I got some questions because I don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand. The first one is that my wife, when she came close to me and she told I like that when she, when I feel itching in my head, she scratches me. But when she does that, I feel something like evil.
I was trying to tell you, the Lord wanted me to tell you about your wife. Your wife needs deliverance. She needs deliverance. And he wants you to deliver her. You are the... Yes, you are the head of your house. That is your house. That belongs to you. You are a child of God. You believe in Christ Jesus. And as a servant of the Most High God, remember now, on a job, if the owner of the company that you work with has selected you as a supervisor and giving you delegated authority to supervise his employees, wouldn't you use that authority to supervise those employees? Because the owner had delegated that authority to you to do. You would do that. Is that correct?
Okay.
Well, Jesus Christ have delegated you his authority.
Okay.
Cast spirits out of his house. A person's body is a house for the Holy Ghost, no demon.
Okay.
So you have delegated authority in Jesus' name. Do you believe that, Brian?
Yeah, I do.
Since you believe that, Jesus said, these signs shall follow them who believe in my name. They shall cast out devils, heal the sick, raise the dead. Freely they receive, free do they give. So Jesus had delegated you that authority. Plus, that is your wife.
Okay.
That is your wife.
And other things.
So what the Lord wants you to do, you talk to your wife.
Uh-huh.
And you let your wife know that she has a spirit husband. Tell her that the man that's coming to her in the dream that looks like you, that is not you.
Uh-huh.
Tell her that is not you. That is a demon spirit masquerading as you to have sex with her.
Okay.
She thinks it's a dream, but it's not a dream.
Okay.
Okay? Witchcraft is in her family lineage. It's like witchcraft was in your family lineage. So after you mention that to her and let her know that Jesus has set you free from a same spirit, and now Jesus wants to set her totally free. And then you just use your delegated authority in Jesus, and you command spirit husband, and you say, pack your load, you know, because there are some more spirits in there, too, that's under spirit husband leadership. You say, pack your load, and you get out. You get out of God's house. You get out of her mind, her will, her emotions, her body. Just like I did you, you do her the same way.
And you know something,
Lord,
sister? I thought that yesterday. I said, Lord, did I speak with my wife and tell her I want to pray for her, and maybe she needs even. But I was like, I don't know. Did I talk with my wife? Did I not? Now you are confirmed that word, and I want to tell you something.
Mm-hmm.
2 days ago, I was in my living room. Suddenly, the TV turned on. Somebody was in the couch and turned on the TV.
Mm-hmm.
In the TV, I was seeing like demons, like Satanists, to that person, hey, don't put that. But the person didn't care, didn't. Suddenly, I trust him, and I start to praying for him and rebuking him. And I say, Holy Ghost, fire. And I start to put my hands in and he start to shake like he was convulsioning.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I say Holy Ghost fire, it was not me. It was like a brother who has that gift. And I see like in the body of, I don't know if this person or this spirit is like something around him, like I don't know if it was fire or not, but I feel that when I say Holy Ghost fire, it was like a power start to attack in this. Began like a child, and I say, I do you want to get liver? And she said, yes. And I start to rebuke him, and then I woke up, and I don't know. Sometimes I deliver another people or doing that, but I don't know if it's a call from them.
Oh, it is. It is, and also it shows me that it's that spirit husband in your house. It's taking control. It wants to take control of your house. It's acting as though it's the husband of the house. It's not the husband. You are the husband. And you remember that Holy Ghost fire, the Holy Spirit is in you. It's Jesus Christ. Jesus needs you to to take authority, to open your mouth and speak his will on earth. And as you speak his will on earth, it's Jesus Christ who's actually is doing the work. That demon got to go. Lord wants you to cast that spirit out of your wife. Talk to your wife. Let her know what God has done for you. Tell her the man that she sees in her dream coming to her having said, that is not you. That's that spirit who claimed her as a wife and it, as her husband, and she needs to be delivered.
What?
Mm-hmm. Hello?
Yeah, did you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you now.
Okay. When I shake hands with people, sometimes I feel something from that people, like a heaviness.
Yeah, they need deliverance.
Bad energy, and but I don't know. It's not everybody. Sometimes I shake hands for my brothers, and nothing happens.
Yeah.
But sometimes in another body, I hug, it's like I feel bad, and I don't know what is that. Is it a gift? Is discernment?
Discerning the spirit. That is a gift of discerning the spirit. So you need to realize your country, where you are, you know, your people, they are involved in witchcraft. You know, I don't know the name of that demon god that they worship, but That's what they worship. And a lot of them never been detached. Even though they became Christian, they never got delivered, and they never been detached from that ungodly covenant of idolatry and witchcraft. So therefore, by you being totally free now, when you meet someone, you shake their hands or just looking at them, you're going to actually feel those spirits, because those spirits know that you are a child of God. Because those spirits, when they look at you, Brian, they see light. They see this great and mighty light. And you're just going to feel that different. But you smile at the person. You smile at the person, and you, within yourself, be praying to God that God will work his word to deliver them as he has delivered you. And then as the Holy Spirit will, he would give you instruction. But the Lord, our Lord said, you do not have to fear. If you can just see the angels that are around you, I mean, you have more protectors around you than you realize. So again, the Holy Spirit, because of your environment, your country, the Holy Spirit is going to manifest in your life through the gift of discerning the spirit. So he let you know what type of spirit is in a person.
Yeah, because sometimes, for be honest, I don't want to shake their hands. I identify a lot of people. And when
shake
I do that or
I
talk to them, I feel bad.
I understand, because I was the same way, but I shook their hand anyway. You shake the person's hand. You're not shaking that demon hand. You shake the person's hand. Remember, God died for that person. Remember your battle. The battle is not against the person. It's against the spirits that's in them that got them to see and bow. So you show love toward the person by shaking their hand. But at the same time, as you shake the person's hand, you're using your authority in the Lord, and you're coming against that spirit that's in them. Mm-hmm. Now, Lord, I'm going to tell you, after a while, you're going to see those spirits in people. You're going to actually see those spirits. And he's not going to show you those spirits so you can be withdrawn from the people. He's showing you those spirits so you can have more love for the person, because the person don't even know that they found.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit.
And Perry, if I start to pray into the Lord, because I don't know if I am baptized with the Holy Ghost, with the Holy Spirit, with fire.
You keep on seeking the Lord the way you seeking the Lord, Brian. Jesus is the baptizer. Jesus Christ is the baptizer. And you keep seeking the Lord the way you're seeking him, before you know it, all of a sudden, you're going to feel that cool and refreshness in your belly and the sound that's coming up out of your mouth, and you're going to be speaking with other tongues to your Heavenly Father. It's your spirit praying to your Heavenly Father.
Okay.
Because Jesus will baptize you. No ifs and buts about it. He will baptize you if you continue to seek him the way that you're seeking him. Because he got a mighty work for you to do. But he wants to first get your house clean. So man need to get his own house clean before he can allow the Lord to go clean another man's house. But
okay.
He starts right there at home first. Praise
okay.
his holy name. Glory.
Okay.
And you keep me informed, you keep me posted, because I want to hear that good news. But the main
okay.
thing is to kick that man out your house. You know, if there was a human man come trying to take control of your house, you would kick that man out. You would use
yeah.
your authority as the husband and kick him out. Well, the Lord said he wants you to kick out that spirit man who's trying to take over your house.
Okay.
Okay. Amen.
Thank you very much.
Amen. You're welcome, Brian. Okay, I'm thank God that you finally called back, because I was waiting. I was waiting so much, I totally forgot. I said, well, Lord, maybe he got the message, because I knew the enemy was going to try his best to get you to think, because we were disconnected. You didn't hear it, that they didn't go anywhere, and that's a lie. That's a lie. Amen. But continue to stay blessed. Okay?
Okay. Thank you very much. God bless you.
We'll talk another time. You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Praise God. So thankful that Brian called back. Praise God. Now, for those of you, you know, you can go to my YouTube channel, and I can't think, it's about a month ago, so you look for deliverance sessions with Brian from Mexico. I can't remember the exact episode, and feel free just to listen. So I'm going to bring on 7053 on the line, and I see I have another international caller, look like from the UK. So I need to go ahead and bring in 7053, because they called in yesterday and waited so long. And then after 7053, then you who calling from the UK, then I bring you in next. Okay? So let me bring on 7053. Okay, 7053, what's your first name and the state you calling from?
Tanisha Harris, calling from Dawson, Georgia.
Did you say Melissa?
Tanisha,
what, T-A-N-E-S-H-A. Have I had a message to you before?
Oh, I had been trying to get in contact with you.
I seen this name before. Tanisha.
Yeah, I had been trying to message you on Google and Facebook, I think.
Oh, okay, that's probably I've seen you. Okay. All right, Tanisha. What is it you want the Lord to do?
I want to be delivered from some things so I can be able to serve God like I want to, because I've been like in and out like I want to stay, but something like just keeping me from believing that I'm set free and I don't know, like I be feeling like I'm not having any peace, and like I'm feeling like kind of numb, like don't feel, I don't know, I can't describe it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. But the main thing, Tanisha, is that you are in obedience to God now. You close all those doors. Because that's the only way these spirits are going to leave. Those doors must be closed.
Mm-hmm.
No open door. Just so
be. I guess be the people that I be around and the things that they listen to and they try to get me involved in it. Like.
Mm-hmm. And you haven't connected yourself to them.
Ma'am.
You haven't connected yourself to those people. See, in other words, you can't fellowship with them the way they want you to fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
Because through that ungodly relationship, that's an open door where demons will enter and travel in you.
Mm.
We have to watch our relationship. Because, you know, the Word of God said, light have no fellowship with darkness. That is so true.
Mm.
So the things the things that they do, you're not doing the things that they do. Because they do things that's contrary to the will of God.
Yes.
You can't be heaven, if you're not married, you cannot be heaven set, cannot be smoking, you cannot be enjoying their 50 conversation, you know, talking about what, you know, in times past, what you've done sexually. You know, such people, you know, in conversation, you cannot attach yourself to it, because if you do, those demons will never leave. See, we have to watch our relationship.
Mm-hmm. I'm married, but he's remarried.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so.
Okay.
That's on him.
We're talking about you, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, also now, if you've been following me, you know, even though you're married, you have to keep your bedroom pure and holy. You know, there can't be any aestheticism in the marital bed, because Satan will tell married people, when you're married, you can do whatever you want to do in that bedroom. That's between them mm-hmm. and God. There, you're right. That's between them and God. That's the reason why God bringing it up. Because some married people are doing things they ain't got no business, and it's open the door for demon spirits. And that's why they unfaithful to their spouse. Can't be bringing mm-hmm. in aestheticism and marriage to be in. So you have to make sure, you know, that door is closed as well. We have to be obedient to God. Because God made certain parts of the body for intercourse. The other parts of the body was never made and designed for intercourse. That's aestheticism. Mm-hmm. And that's an open door for demons to come into the bedroom and come into a person and reside. So we have to stay pure and holy in that area as well. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. So again, you know, the main thing is that you must stay in obedience in order to keep this deliverance. Because, again, any open door disobedience, these spirits are coming back. And when they come back, they're coming back with 7 more demon spirits, more worse than they are. And you'll be worse off before you call me. The Lord told me there have been many, after they called me, they got set free, but they were disobedient and demons came back. And the Lord said, they literally said, man, I was better off before I called Evans King. I should have called her. No, you should have stayed in obedience. That's what you should have done. Stayed in obedience. How old is your baby?
She's gonna be 3 months Sunday.
Oh, I felt like she was a few months old. Oh yes, Tanisha. She really need mom to get delivered so mom can keep her covered. Mom can keep her covered, because if you're not delivered, then those same demons that torment you, whether you realize or not, they'll torment your little baby. It's a little girl. Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
They tormented that little girl. That's why she'll cry strangely at night, and you'll be thinking she's hungry, and she still cry. That's not the reason why those demons are tormenting her. You know, I know this by the word of God, and plus from experience with my daughter. You know, I have a little granddaughter who's over a year now, and my daughter, she got delivered. Lord used me to cast those spirits out of her. But every now and then, those spirits will try to come back, and they'll attack her little girl. And so I told her what she needs to do. Use her authority and put her hands over her baby and command every spirit, now the Holy Spirit, to come out, because the baby daddy is not saved. You know, and he visits, just before the baby was born, he visits a psychic. See, he visits a psychic. So there's a spirit of an old lady that have a tendency to come try to visit my little granddaughter. And Lord told me to tell the mom, and the mom had to be the one to take that authority, because it's her child. It's not my child. It's her child. Mm-hmm. I only can do is keep them covered. But mom can use her authority to command that spirit to leave her child. And my daughter had done it numerous times, where she asked the Lord, let her see this old lady spirit. And I told her where it came from. And she had commanded it to leave her child. It's a battle. So mom needs to get delivered to keep that little baby protected. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then trust the Lord that God will work a work to turn the daddy around. All right?
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have to tell me anything, Tanisha, because I know how these spirits got into you. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
And for time's sake, I'm just going to use my thoughts in Jesus' name, and I'm going to throw them out in the name of Jesus. But the Lord wants you to maintain your deliverance, but you're going to have to cut off some relationship. You cannot allow people to just come around you talking in any and every kind of way. What they say is not building your faith in Christ Jesus. You need to open up your mouth and look. I don't care for that conversation. Especially with your little children, your little child, because whether you realize it or not, what is that child is hearing is going into her hearing and going to go down into her heart. So not only you need to protect yourself, but you need to protect your little baby. Okay?
Yes,
praise his holy name. And I give you some more instructions on your little baby after your deliverance. So I'm going to go ahead and pray, Tanisha. So Father, in Jesus' name, again, I thank you for this opportunity to minister your love and grace to your daughter, Tanisha. Father, I thank you that it's her time now to truly shine forth and bring only glory to your son, Jesus Christ. For every plan, purpose, and idea that you have for her, it shall come to pass in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for the angels that you have surrounded her and her family, especially that little baby. I thank you, Father, that no weapon formed against them, it cannot prosper. It cannot be successful in what it's set out to do. I thank you for dispatching your angels right now in the spirit realm at their house. And every darkness that has surrounded that little baby's crib, I thank you, Father, that the angels have drove them out. And I give you praise and I give you glory. And I ask you to continue to give Tanisha revelation, understanding of who she is in your son Jesus and who Jesus is in her. Father, I ask you to open her spiritual eyes to only see that which you desire her to see. Her spiritual ears open it to hear that which you desire her to hear, Father. Make her king in the spirit, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. And I thank you for the peace that you given and leave with this family, Father. I thank you, Father, for increasing her trust and her faith only in your word. Thank you, Father, for cleansing your house for true worship. I give you praise and give you all the glory. And I continue to thank you for being present on this phone line, because you still continue to say, as always, when we come together in your son's name, you are here with us always. And whatever we bind and loose on earth, Father, you bind and you're the one who looses into heaven. So right now, in Jesus' name, I'm taking authority. I command you, spirit husband, pack your load and get out of God's house. You get out of her mind. You get out of her will. You get out of her emotions. You get out of her visions. And you get out of her dreams and her body. Get out of her body. Out of her body in Jesus' mighty name. For the blood of Jesus has forgiven her. The blood of Jesus forgave her ancestors. The blood of Jesus has already set her totally free. In Jesus' mighty name, you have no more legal right to remain in her or in her house in Jesus' mighty name. And I command you to get out in Jesus' name. Holy Ghost fire. Holy Ghost, go set ablaze. Search and destroy darkness that is dormantly residing in Tanisha's will. Burn by your fire. Burn every spirit in her will that has exalted itself against God's knowledge. Burn, Holy Ghost. Don't leave no area in her will untouched by your mighty fire. continue to set ablaze darkness that's lurking and hiding dormantly in her emotions. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn every spirit in her emotion that has exalted itself and lift itself against the knowledge of God. Set her emotions ablaze by your mighty fire. Burn darkness that's in her emotion. Burn darkness that's in her emotion. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn darkness that's in her emotion. Destroy darkness in her emotion in Jesus' mighty name. Continue to set ablaze darkness that is lurking and hiding dormantly in her mind. Burn darkness in her mind. Burn every spirit in her mind that has exalted itself against God's knowledge. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn in her mind. Burn, Holy Ghost, in Jesus' mighty name. Continue to consume darkness that's lurking, hiding dormantly in her body. Burn, Holy Ghost. Set her body completely ablaze by your mighty fire. Search and destroy darkness that's hiding in her eyes. Burn darkness that is in her eyes. Burn darkness that is in her nostrils. Burn darkness that is in her ears. Burn darkness that is in her throat. Burn darkness that is in her belly. Set her belly ablaze. Burn darkness in her belly, up and down her arms and her legs. Burn darkness that's in her fallopian tube, in her womb, in her uterus. Burn darkness from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. Burn darkness that is attached in her body, on her body. Burn every illegal mark that has been made on and in her body. Burn every illegal image that has been made in and on her body. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn every illegal ring and jewelry that has been placed in and on her body. Set it ablaze by your mighty fire. Ransack her body. Ransack her will. Ransack her emotions. Ransack her mind by your fire in Jesus' mighty name. By faith, I take God's scissors in the spirit realm, and I cut and detach her from that ungodly covenant of idolatry and witchcraft. For the blood of Jesus has detached her. The blood of Jesus detached her. The blood of Jesus detached her. The blood of Jesus set her free. The blood of Jesus destroys all covenants. Contract that is known or unknown to her. The blood of Jesus set her free. I detach her from that evil spirit marriage, evil spirit husband, spirit wife, those spirit children, that spirit family. I disconnect her by the blood of Jesus, for the blood of Jesus set her free. Even in this natural realm, every relationship that the Father did not connect her to, I disconnect by faith in Jesus' mighty name, every relationship in the name of Jesus. In Jesus Christ's name, be free, Tanisha. Be totally free in your mind. Be totally free in your mind. Be totally free in your will. Be totally free in your emotions. Be totally free in your mind. Be totally free in your dreams. Be totally free in your vision and be totally free in your body to serve and worship the Lord thy God. And him only will you serve in spirit and truth. Be free in Jesus' mighty name. Father, I ask you to fill Tanisha. Fill her to overflow with your spirit. Fill her, Father. Fill her mind, her will, her emotions, her dreams, her vision, and her body with your spirit, Father. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name, I also pray for Tanisha's house. Holy Ghost fire, go in her house. Search and destroy darkness that is hiding and lurking in every room, corner, crack, and crevice of the house. Destroy darkness under every bed, around the bed, under the bed, between the sheets and the mattress. Destroy darkness that's even over the crib, around the crib, under the crib. Destroy darkness. Find their dark hiding places and destroy darkness in Jesus' name. Don't leave no area in her house or on her property untouched by your fire. Go outside the house, burn over the house, under the house, around the house. even underground objects, planted, known or unknown to her, even burnt objects that were thrown in the waters in her name, Father. Burn in Jesus' name. Burn those evil objects in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name. Destroy every negative word that had been sent against her in her family. In her child. Destroy negative words, those evil negative words. Destroy it by your mighty fire in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. You're free, Tanisha, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glory to your holy name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Tanisha,
ma'am.
It's done in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
You are totally free in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord. Glory to his name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Just glorify him. Now, you are free. So after we hang up the phone, I want you to put your hands on your baby and bless your baby. And I want you to say these words. You look through your baby. Don't look at your baby. But look through your baby and you say, every spirit, not of the Holy Spirit, I command you to come out of her mind, come out of her will, you come out of her emotions, and you come out of her body in Jesus' name. And then you say, Holy Ghost fire, burn, burn in her mind. So it's only the Holy Ghost who can burn darkness out of the mind, the will, the emotions, and the body. And you send Holy Ghost to burn those things. Burn darkness out of those areas. And then you ask your Heavenly Father to fill your daughter with his spirit. And then every night before she go to bed, you put your hands on her head and you pray for her and pray a prayer of protection in Jesus' name every night. Okay? Make sure now in her room you don't be accumulating things like these days, you know, when they make things for children, they be so cute, but you need to stop looking at that cuteness. The images and the things they put on baby stuff, you don't need to get those things because demons are attached to those things. You know, especially with Disney, they love to make a lot of baby things with Disney characters. Disney is into witchcraft. Don't fill her room with such stuff because when you do that, demons are attached to it, and you are putting darkness in her room, and they will torment that child. Even the bed, her little bedding, the beddings, you got to be careful. Even the strollers, the baby handbag, you got to watch everything. You have to watch. You have to ask the Holy Spirit, you know, what are these designs? What are these characters attached to? That's why babies getting tormented by demons, and that's why you hear stories of Sid. They think the baby just died. No, demons be smothering, killing those babies. That's who to blame, because the devil one who kills, who steals, and who destroys. So you have to watch those things. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
You understand? If you got such thing, you get rid of it and go and buy other things that don't have such things on. You know, I brought that to my daughter's attention with my little granddaughter because she wasn't aware, and she knows the baby was just crying. And I told her, I said, you need to stop getting those things. Pay better attention to what you get. Satan is very cunning. He's sneaky. He works with designer. He gives designer suggestions, especially with little babies. You know, those babies are being tormented by demons because the parents are putting all those things. You know, don't be getting your baby teddy bears and little dolls. Don't get those things. Demons attach themselves to such things. You know, you look at them, they look like regular teddy bears and look like regular dolls, but you don't know the spirit that is attached to them. And then when you go sleep at night, those spirits come out of those things. The baby can't say, the babies can't tell you. They can't tell you. You just be careful. Even with people, when they give you things to give to the baby, you take it and you look at it. The Holy Spirit what is this about? Is this okay? And the Holy Spirit will let you know. If he say it's fine, you give it to your baby. If not, you say thank you, but when you take it home, you throw it outside the trash. You got to be protected. You know, don't be handing your baby to everybody. Everybody. I made that mistake with my first baby. And the Lord brought it to my attention when I gave my baby to this one lady and my baby flinched. I said, why my baby flinching? And the Lord said, you are letting different people hold your baby. You need to stop. And I stopped. And she no longer flinched like that. Because people carry bad spirits. And when you hand them your child, you're giving them permission to handle your child. So you have to be very protective of that. So don't forget, after we hang up, you do as the Lord said, put your hands on, and you command every spirit, not a whole spirit, to come out of her mind, her will, emotions, and her body.
Mm-hmm.
And then ask the Lord to feel her, and you pray for her every night. And then you go in her room, and you pray over her room, and things in that room that shouldn't be, as the Holy Spirit leads you, you need to get it out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
See, her dad bought her a little dog from the flea market, a little play dog, and it's purple, and the eyes are green, and I was like, this don't look right.
You see, that's God tell you. You get rid of that thing. Let him get mad. If he get mad, you just have to get mad. This is my baby.
Yeah, he'll get mad about this stuff.
But you let, remember, it's the devil in him that's getting mad.
Mm-hmm.
No, you throw that thing out. You throw it out. That thing attacking your baby. Next thing you know, your baby have difficult breathing. And you run there, what's wrong with my baby? What's wrong with my baby? You run to the hospital. And the first thing they can say, she been attacked with SIDS. No, that's a demon. See, we have to be protected of our babies. We just can't keep taking things for granted. And he got that thing. Don't tell him where that thing originated and from who and what they did. Oh, you get rid of such things. You just have to get mad. I recently had this mirror. I've been having that mirror for years and years. Never felt like nothing was wrong with it. But as I continue to get deeper and deeper in things of God, I noticed that it just felt like there was a little baby spirit that kept walking up and down the hallway.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, what in the world? And I feel like there's a little baby spirit. And then I was watching this program about, you know, how some a lot of times the devil would use mirrors as a portal to enter through.
Mm-hmm.
And especially with the design of that mirror. Not all mirrors are like that, but this particular one. But this particular one, they do have a strange design on the edges, but I really never paid attention to it. So as I was watching that program, and I got to thinking, I said, and I knew, I just felt like somebody would just would walk up and down the hallway, a little hall that we got. And I said, well, one thing up and down the hallway is that mirror. And I looked and I said, you know what? I'm going to get real of you. I said, I'm just going to get real of you. Now, my mother's been with us for a few years now. And my stepfather let me use the mirror many years ago. He let me keep it, but then he died. So when he died, it really became mine. And my mother had never concerned herself with that mirror. Never, ever, ever. But what was strange, all of a sudden, she concerned herself with that mirror. She called it her mirror. I said, well, Lord, that's strange. She never called that mirror hers. And right then, that's when I knew, okay, something is wrong. Something is wrong. So I told my daughter, I said, well, y'all get a chance, take the mirror down and put it in the trash. She said, oh, thank you, Mama, thank you. I said, well, she said, I've been wanting to get rid of that mirror. It was just something about it around the edges that I just didn't like. I said, why didn't you say something? I just didn't say nothing. I said, well, get rid of it. And finally, we got rid of that thing. And I don't feel like something walking up and down that hall anymore. So things like that, we have to get rid of. And that thing, that dog, you get rid of that thing. The devil in your husband just have to get mad. He'll get over it. That is your child. You know, and right now you're the only one spiritually who can protect your child. You know, he's looking in the natural, you're looking in the spirit. So just be obedient to the Lord, Tanisha. It's done. So as I was praying, Tanisha, what was you experiencing or what was happening as I was praying?
I was starting to feel a little peace, and then like a cry within myself or something. Like something wanted to cry. I don't know.
Did you say like something wanted to cry?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, was that demon? That demon that was leaving. That was that demon that was in your emotion. It really was really living strongly in your emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't want to go, but it had to go. That wasn't you. That was that spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So praise God, you are totally free. You go ahead.
A lot of times, my emotions do, like, I don't know, like they switch. I can't explain it, but I'm saying to myself, I say, I don't believe that this is me. I say, I believe that it's something deeper than just me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I have a lot of stuff going on, like in my feelings and in my mind, and stuff like, and I start to feel trapped in my mind, like, I can't, I just started to get frustrated with it.
Mm-hmm. It was that spirit, because as I was praying in different compartments of your soul, I really felt a strong prayer regarding your emotion. So that let me know that those spirits are really, really residing in your emotion.
Mm-hmm.
So they are totally gone now. That means your mind, your will, your emotion, your body is totally free. Demons are no longer living in there. So you continue to stay in obedience to the Lord and watch your relationship. Just don't allow people to be around you talking in every way. Again, if what they say is not what Jesus said, you have to excuse yourself from that conversation because you don't want to go in your hearing. You don't want to go in your hearing, because if you let it go into your hearing, demons are going to go right into your hearing. Okay? Amen.
Mm-hmm.
It's done in Jesus' name. So continue to praise him and bless his holy name. Okay?
Oh, well, yeah. And I have a son. Right. He's been going back and forth to the doctors for about 2 years or whatever. They say he's a plastic anemic. And he had to get a port in his chest or whatever. And it every time I start to try to get my life in order with God, like this when something will go on with that, like he'll start bleeding real bad or something like that, or go on with him, his levels will drop and stuff. So I caught on to it. I said something not right. I said it seemed like every time I try to come back to God, that's when these things starting to occur with my son.
Yeah, that's the issue. Now, how old is your son?
He's 10.
Okay. He's there with you as well?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, well, you do the same thing to him. Same thing as I tell you to your little girl, you do him the same way, because that is the enemy trying to discourage you from getting a closer and deeper walk with the Lord. So you do the same thing, okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, you stay blessed, all right?
Okay.
All right, then. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Praise God. Praise God. Okay, let me see who's next here. I see that. Let me see. 9344 is calling back from yesterday. So, and I also see a number from UK. So, UK, I'm going to have to bring 9344 on because they called yesterday, waited for a long time, and I promised them that I give them priority. So, I will bring on the UK after 9344. Okay, 9344, you calling in for a session?
Hello, yes, ma'am. Hiya.
Okay. Hi. Right. Now, what's your first name and the state you're calling from?
My first name is Dee. I'm in Arkansas.
Did you say Z?
D.
Oh, D, from Arkansas. Okay. And how do you find out about me?
I was searching online because of some things that my son and myself were experiencing. And I found you. So I listened to your YouTube videos and heard some of your sessions. Well, this would be the third session that I've heard. I've called before, and you said some things to me that I couldn't receive then, but God has shown me, and I asked him to show me my heart like he told me to. And so I apologize that I wasn't able to receive what you were saying then, and I am really submitted to God to be able to hear.
I'm trying to remember you. You say you called. How long ago did you call, D?
I think it was like 3 months ago or 2 months ago.
And you said you didn't receive. Okay. Now, what was it exactly at that time that you did not receive? And maybe I can remember.
Well, we were talking about I had emailed you a long email of everything that I had remembered. I was thinking about everything that had ever happened in my lifetime. But since we had that conversation, God has brought some other things to my heart as well to confess to him, and I've been confessing those things to him.
Okay, now, are you the young lady that I told that you're making your little son a God? He's a God in your eyesight.
Yes.
It's the same young girl. Oh, this is you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that's strange. You came to my mind. I think a few days ago you came to my mind, but I didn't dwell on it. I just went on. I guess I should have dwelled on it. I guess God right then was working into you. But you did come to my mind, and, you know, it kind of was a little sad because I said, Lord, it'll be sad. She's going to wait all those many years and see exactly what you want her. For her to see what I was telling her would happen to her son when it could have been prevented. See, that's what God does. You know, that's what God does. God will reveal to her. You call it a word of wisdom. It's a word of wisdom. It's a word of wisdom. Things that will happen in the future. They have not happened yet in the future. And the reason why the Holy Spirit manifests himself and giving his child a word of wisdom, just a word of wisdom, is so the person can prevent that from happening. You want it to be prevented from happening, but because you don't see it happen yet, you automatically say, no, that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. You know, that's what, in other words, that's what Peter told the Lord. Peter, you know, was telling the Lord how he would die for him. He was just bragging how he died for him. The Lord just went on and gave him a word of wisdom. Peter, you're going to deny me. And Peter, in other words, Peter looked at the Lord and said, in other words, Peter said, you're a liar. I would never do that. Peter disowned or did not believe what God told him. Not until it happened. Now, if Peter, when God told Peter that, if he would have humbled himself and said, Lord, God only knows. Please, Lord, help me not to deny you, then God could have prevented Peter from ever denying him. You see? But that's what you call the gift of a word of wisdom. It tells what is going to happen in the future. And the reason why the Holy Spirit tells us so that we can do what we should do to avoid it, especially, you know, if it's not something that's pleasing in our eyesight, we can avoid that. He don't just give us information just to be giving us information. He gives us information so that we can do something about it. So praise God, D, that you did come to see truth, because God loves you, and he definitely loves that little boy. He loves us all. He loves us all. But before God can help us, we always must admit and confess to our wrongdoings. It's easy to confess to God what other people have done to us or what we think other people may be doing to us, but that's not going to help us. Only way we're going to be helped, we must confess to God our own wrongdoing. Because if we had not done wrong, these problems that we have would not have never happened. So that's the reason why when people come to me, you know, I get them to focus on their own wrongdoing. Don't tell me about what your husband has done, your ex has done. No, we're talking about you. You confess to your own wrongdoing. You need to get right with God. Because these, when we stand before God, we're only going to give account to what we have done, not to what someone else has done to us, but what we have done. God told me that many years ago with my husband. I went to him about my husband. He said, I'm not going to reward you based on how Roger treat you. I'm going to reward you based on how you treat Roger. And so I changed. I changed. I start watching myself. Regardless of how my husband acts, how he treat me, I love him, and I treat him the way that Jesus told me to love him and the way Jesus told me to treat him, because I'm going to have to give an account to what I do and give an account to what I say. So praise God that you come to see that, because, again, I can write, just like you, I can write a long letter. If I look back on my life and talk about how other people done to me and what they say and what they is saying today, I can have a gigantic book, but I don't do that. I don't focus on that. I stay aware of myself, what I do, you know, how I treat others, how I look at others. And I want Jesus to help me. And when we humble, and that's humbling yourself, and when we humble ourselves that way, Dee, then God said, I can help you. I can help you. But an arrogant, prideful spirit, he avoids. He has nothing to do with an arrogant, prideful spirit. Because an arrogant, prideful spirit always looks at what other people are doing to them. So praise his holy name. So thank God that you come to see that. So you don't have to repeat all of that, okay?
You
understand? We're not going to repeat all of that. All we want now is for the Lord to deliver Dee, and what's your son's name?
James.
To deliver Dee and James. That's what we want God to do, okay? So that Dee can live a righteous and holy lifestyle in front of James. So when James look at Dee, which is his mother, he's going to see Jesus, and he's going to imitate as Jesus, as he see Jesus act and react to his mom, okay? Because I got a little granddaughter, and I know it's the only way she learned is she learned by what she see all of us do. She imitate what we do. She imitate what we say. So, therefore, we want James to see and hear him imitate what Dee is doing as Dee imitate what God have done and what God said, and how Dee react. She's going to react the way Jesus Christ reacts, so James can react the way Jesus Christ reacts. That's all what's important. It's not his father. His father has detached himself out of this picture here. It don't matter even what he's trying to do. You need to stop focusing on that. If you could keep your focus on Jesus Christ so your son can see your actions and your reactions as Jesus Christ, Jesus is the one who's going to take care of your problems. He'll take care of things that you're not able to take care of. That's why we always must remember first things are first, and that is seeking God, his kingdom, and his righteousness. Being in right standing with him. These other things that we need for him to do, he will do it. He will fight that battle for us. He will fight a battle that we don't even know that a battle is on against us. He will fight that battle. So that's what's important, Dee, is that you keep your focus on him. So your actions and for some reason, I strongly feel your reactions. Satan really gets you with those reactions, okay? Your reaction must be in Christ Jesus, must be just like the Lord, you know.
I have a really hard time with that, and I've looked at that. You know, before you have a child, you say, well, this is the way I'm going to treat my child, and I'm going to do all the right stuff, and I see myself saying, thinking, feeling stuff that I'd never thought I would, just out of frustration and doing things by myself, with God by my side, and just being grateful that God is by my side, yet still frustrated and annoyed and feeling alone, but I mean, feeling lonely but not alone. And so I'm just thanking God that he's always been here for us, because we truly love the Trinity. We truly love the Holy Spirit and Jesus and the Father. We truly love him. And we've seen him act in our lives. He's done so many great things for us. And he continues to do so. He always protects us and keeps us safe, regardless of the things that go on. So, see, I've been talking about, first things first. And I was like, what are you talking about? And yet, you know, you get an idea as to what he's talking about, but to hear you say that and to bring it home really helps a lot.
Yeah, that's right. And that's what you need to just focus on. And as you do that, you can see that the other things that you, in your heart, is asking of God, God will take care of those things. He will bring it to pass. He will bring it to pass. But again, Lord said, first thing first, that's seeking him and his kingdom, and being in right standing with him. Amen. So I'm going to pray for you, Dee, and I'm going to pray for your son. And then I don't know if you heard me tell Tanisha after your deliverance and prayer, you put your hands on your son and you command in the name of Jesus in a low tone, but you serious about it because you're speaking to those spirits. And you command every spirit, and you say, every spirit not of the Holy Spirit, for them to come out of his mind, his will, his motions, and his body, in Jesus' name. And then you call on Holy Ghost fire to go in and ransack his mind, his will, his motions, and body, to drive out all manner of darkness that is deeply hiding and lurking dormantly deep down in him. And the Holy Spirit would do that. Then you ask your Heavenly Father to fill his mind, his will, his emotions, body with his spirit. Praise his holy name. And then every night you put your hands on his head and you bless him and you thank the Lord for giving him sweet, peaceful sleep in Jesus' name. And make sure
we have a whole lot of donated furniture.
I'm glad you mentioned that because yesterday it was a young lady and I did a session on and I kept coming up with a couch. And she said she didn't have a couch. Well, something about a couch is coming. I said, if anyone gives you a couch. you were listening. I just kept on. And I thought about it this morning, right? But Lord, a couch kept coming up, but she don't know about a couch, but it was a couch. Because Lord only gives us in part. He don't give us the whole picture. So you speak what he gives you. And I was like, I said, you know what? I wondered if it's for her too, but at that particular moment, I wondered if it was someone who was listening. But I ain't think nothing else about it again, and you said it. Well, yeah. Because you remember I told her, be careful people giving you stuff because they come, demons come attached with those things.
The Catholic Church, they came and donated a lot of furniture.
Jesus. What type of furniture?
Dressers, beds, nightstands, couch.
You know what? It came out of their members' homes. Not a lot of time. A lot of Caucasian people who's rich and they have furniture for a mighty long time, and they are Catholic, so they believe in the Catholic ways, and they have different idols, Mary, the Rosary, and their other different stuff in their house, and demons are drawn to those things. And because demons are drawn to those things, then the whole house became spiritually evil and contaminated. And then they donate the furniture. And then you get the furniture, then all of a sudden you just feel strange in the house. And, you know, every time you sleep on or sit down, you just feel funny. So it's just best not to have such furniture. It's best to sleep on the floor. Just trust the Lord. That God will provide furniture from his surface. Holy furniture. We want holy furniture. And you said your son won't sleep near the furniture.
He won't sleep on his bed. He sits on the sofa. There's been some times where it felt like something was trying to go into our butt. It was well before we got that couch. My son, he had a surgery, and then the next morning after he had that surgery, he started behaving and standing in compromising positions and saying, he said, "F me," things like that that I'd never let him listen to or watch or anything of that nature, nothing I ever watched or anything like that. So I asked the doctor what happened, and it happened through an investigation and everything, and I said they did nothing wrong. But I asked them before they did the surgery what the procedure was, what they were going to do, and they never told me that they were going to put Tylenol up his butt after the surgery. But they did that. But I found out that the doctor, the anesthesia doctor that actually did that, was a Satanist. And my son had been saying stuff like that, doing compromising things. And I'm just like, I've never taught you that. I've never done that, because I had sex since I was 8 months pregnant with him. He's my only child. And so I have masturbated in my lifetime. Masturbated a couple times after I've had him. And when I went to West Africa, when I was in undergrad, I masturbated. And also there was a little boy that I was sitting on my friend's shoulders, and we were walking up the street, and this little boy, he took his finger and put his finger in my vagina. And I was I felt so disrespected. And we were in a different country. I didn't know who to tell. A lot of people were just laughing, and I felt so ashamed. But that was something that happened. But I just, because I grew up in foster care, first I was with my mom, and she had a very abusive type lifestyle. She would be in sex groups and stuff like that, and just abused by men. So I grew up fighting grown men since I was very young, me and my sister. And we grew up around, because my mom did a lot of alcohol and drugs, and her boyfriend made her, he beat her and made her do cocaine in front of us and stuff like that. So there was a lot of stuff that we've seen when we were in foster. Excuse me, son, I need you to go in the other room, please. Thank you. And there was a lot of things that we saw. So we were into foster care, going from home to home from like maybe age 3 and 5, and we went back to our mom then from 5 to 7. My sister was 7, I was 5. So until we were 18, but I've been living in an apartment since I was 17. And since I've had my son, I've never owned my own home, so we've lived in apartments. And before then, before he was born, I lived in apartments, and when I would sometimes have to wait until when the apartment was ready, I was in a motel or a hotel. So there are a lot of different warfares that I had to go through during that time because of different people who lived there before I did. But after I had my son and after that surgery happened, there was this change in my son to where he was angry and defiant and rebellious. He had a lot of gas in his stomach, a lot of pain, and something started afflicting us like it was biting us and trying to have sex with us and going, making this clicking noise on our tongues and our mouth. And something felt like it was trying to go in our mouth. So I started to learn about, because I would ask my aunts were, they've been in the ministry for a long time, and I had been licensed and ordained, but nobody ever taught me how to deal with all this stuff. And I never felt effective having gone through all this stuff, even before I had my son. But after I had my son, it got worse. So, like I said, I stopped having sex. Once I had gotten pregnant with him and everything, and I had him, I wanted to be a good example before him. And I wanted to give him a safe place to live, because I didn't have that growing up when I was first starting out. And his dad didn't want to be in the picture. We talked about a lot of different things, but he never kept his word. I had to take him to court, and then I had to get him to pay child support. And I've always wanted my son's dad to be in the picture, but when he was a month and a half old, he put his hand inside of my son's diaper mm-hmm. while I was in the bathroom, and I came out because I'd already talked to him about my son's diaper. Already hadn't been changed, but when I came out of the bathroom, it was before I heard him say to my son, "Shut up," because my son started crying. And that was just something that I never expected for my son's dad to say to my son, because he had always seemed to be a really loving person with his first child. So I came out the bathroom and I saw him pull his hand out of my son's diaper, and then he started arguing with me and he left. I couldn't even talk to him about it. So I just let him know, well, I'm going to change our son's diaper from this point on. Don't handle his diaper or anything of that nature, because it really alarmed me. Because my sister's dad, when I was little, he would put his semen all over my private part, and he would go in the bathroom and ejaculate and come back out. I mean, or, you know, like, and I've seen him do that to my sister, and he would do that to me, send her to the store and do that to me, send me to the store and do that to her. And my aunt told me that my mom sold us to my sister's dad to get some money and send us up there. And my mom, she would abuse us physically. It's just a lot of stuff that we've been through. So I keep my son from those people who were I love them because they gave them to me as my family, but I know what I've been through with them, so I don't want my son to go through that. My mom. Mm-hmm.
Mm-mm-mm. Hello? D?
Yes.
Okay, I can hear you now. You have phased out.
Mm. I apologize. So my son, I protect him a lot because of the things that I know people are capable of. I want him to lead a life that's that's healthy. And so that's what I try and do for him all the time. But doing it by myself, I've been frustrated a lot. I've said some things. I've even cursed at him. I've even... things that I never thought I would do, I have done. But, I mean, I haven't been, like, abusive like my mom has been to him. And I can say that there's been a line I hadn't crossed. So I did what people at the hospital told me to do when I got upset, put him in one room, make sure he's okay, and then walk out. I've learned a lot from different people. I went to the classes by myself. You know, before I had him. And so I try to do the right thing is what I'm trying to say. Yet there's been a lot that's come against me, and God has always been with me. I'm so grateful.
Yes, praise God. You know, I'm listening to you, Dee, and I'm hearing a totally different person than before. The difference is humility. The Dee that I'm talking to today is humble. I mean, dear heart, when we are humble, God hears us. And he not only hears us, he answers. But an arrogant spirit, he turns away. Now, you know, those of you who tune in on the archive, you might be one of those that listened to Dee's first session where she was very arrogant. And God turned away. But something happened between then and now that humbled her. And I thank God, whatever happened to humble her, I thank God. Because, again, I'm listening to a totally different Dee. You know, when we come to the Lord again, we come with a humble spirit. Come with a humble spirit. That's if we want God to answer us, hear and answer us. Yeah, your son was sodomized.
What?
But, yeah, he was sodomized. I think that's what you call it whenever the male has been poked. I have to watch myself because I listen to so many Africans, especially in South Africa. You know, they say words totally different than what we say. So if you hear me say poke, that means sex. That's what they say in South Africa is poke. But your son was sodomized. That means
his father took his finger and stuck it in his rectum.
Mm-hmm.
And that is because that spirit that keeps passing from one generation to the next generation. Okay. But again, God gonna set you totally free, D, and then the Lord wants you to use your authority in him and put your hands on your son, because that is your son. And command every spirit not of the Holy Spirit to come out of his mind, his will, his motions, and his body. And you're going to have to continue to stand in the gap for your son. Okay?
Okay.
This is something that you're going to have to do, knowing that the battle has already been won. You are walking in total victory, knowing that greater is the Holy Spirit in you than in the mm-hmm. devil in the world, knowing that angels of God have surrounded you and your son, knowing that when you speak the will of God on earth to be done, the Father in heaven, he does it. Okay? And then, again, mm-hmm. go ahead.
I just wonder, as far as the doctor that did that surgery, the anesthesiologist, when he put the Tylenol on my son's rectum, is that considered the same thing, or is that applied
to him? That's considered the same thing. That's sodomizing. You know, it triggered. Now, he may have a medical reason, but that medical reason triggered that generational curse of sodomy.
Wow.
It triggered it. And that's the reason why he have a tendency to say words that is uncommon concerning his rectum, what to do with it. It's those spirits from generations ago.
So my son's dad came to visit. He was driving us from an outing, and his face started turning like a reptile or something like that.
Yeah,
and
reptile.
I didn't know what was going on. I tried to take a picture.
It's a reptilian spirit. A reptilian spirit. Yeah.
And when he talked on the phone, he talked to him about magic and about water and about donkeys and stuff like that. And so I cut off the phone call. And now he's trying to go on to like Skype or whatever, and he doesn't want to show the bottom half of his body. Now he doesn't want to show anything but his head. And so I stopped that too. Now I'm just wondering whether to stop all of that, that conversation or that communication between them two altogether.
If you can.
Because my son is like, I want to talk to daddy, but it's not beneficial at all at this point.
Since he's your father, since he's his father, that's why I said if you can. But if you can, I will make sure that I'm present. You need to make sure that you're present, you're around them. If it means being on the other end of the phone somehow or another, make sure you are present to monitor the conversation and to monitor what he does, because that reptilian spirit in him have a tendency to manifest. Yeah, it would definitely be monitored. Because that's what I tell my daughter. Of course, my daughter, little girl, my granddaughter, her father don't have anything to do with her, because he got angry with me, because after she was born, he thought that he could come and visit my house anytime he got ready, when before he never done that. So I had to use my authority and tell him to, look, you don't show up whenever you want to show up. You call, and then we will schedule you to come over. Well, he didn't like that, and he took it as I told him he couldn't see his child. And so he doesn't see the child. So my daughter know what type of environment that is, and she said, well, mommy, if he come and want to take her to his house, I said, you go and you monitor. I said, if they're smoking in there, you say, give me my child. She's not going in that smoke. I said, you have to monitor. Of course, I knew she didn't have to worry about that, because I knew he won't want to see his child, because he's not no responsible father. He's not a responsible father. So you have to monitor it. You have to monitor, because that reptilian spirit is in him. And that thing will manifest to talk to your son, because it wants to go to another generation. So being a godly mother, you have to monitor those visits. The Holy Spirit will teach you how to monitor it. And you always use your authority and bind that spirit. You know it's a reptilian spirit. Now you need to bind that spirit where it cannot and will not manifest in Jesus' mighty name. You might not can cast it out of your son's father, but you can command it not to manifest and not to talk to your son in Jesus' name. You use your godly authority.
Okay, and when I was in the, we stayed in a different state, and his dad came to visit, and he went into our bathroom. He was supposed to be taking a shower, but he didn't turn on the water, and he was in there for 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was asking him what he was doing, and then he came out. My son was going in there to see what he was doing and things, and he came out. My son came out with him, and he had his hands on his dad's waist, and he was trying to put his face on his dad's crotch. And so I had to keeping him away from, because that's not the only time that my son did that too. But I was like, why is he doing that? That's the second time that's happened. So I keep him, actually at church I had to teach somebody to hug him, because we hug each other at church. Let him hug away from your crotch. You hug him away. Give him that respect.
Right, right.
And teach
right.
him how to do it the right way.
Right. That's right.
So that too. But before those three incidents, that's never happened before. And so it made me wonder whether there was something else has happened.
Yeah, that spirit in him keep manifesting and wants to lure your son into that darkness, keep him in that bound to that darkness as he got his father bound to that darkness. But you now, after your deliverance, you have a legal right. You'll be totally free to bind that spirit.
Well,
that spirit in which it cannot and will not manifest around your son. Because, again, it may come a time that you might not be able to prevent your son from being around his father. Because of the law. And when that happens, then that's when you use your godly authority to bind that spirit. Because the man himself, he loves his son. It's that spirit in him that takes control of him and doing these things. It's not the man, it's that spirit in him. But because of the choices that man is making, he's helpless in that. He can't prevent the spirit from taking control and charge over him. But you, after your deliverance, use your authority in Christ Jesus and bind that spirit. And the Lord let me see a lot of men have that reptilian spirit. You know, if God was to pull back the skin, you would actually see a crocodile, an alligator. That's a reptilian spirit. So I'm
I went to West Africa and I pet a crocodile. There's one more thing,
mm-hmm.
if you don't mind.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
Okay. Since around 2006, there's been like some type of stalking feeling or harassment. Like I would go home from work and like somebody had been in my apartment and has been eating some of my food, going through my panty drawer, stuff like that. But after my son dad, I guess last year, came and he visited, there's been like this coughing that my son had been doing, and there's been like a smell of vomit or cologne smell, semen smell in our apartment when we get back home. I would check, you know, when I do my laundry and stuff, and I come back or I would go in the next morning after we come back, and I would go in to get, you know, my clothes, my underclothes and things. They would smell like somebody's worn them. And then I would smell like fish or just stuff like this. My stomach would start hurting. My son would complain about his stomach hurting. I would look at some of his underwear, and it would smell like a guy. I remember when I had a guy that it was an ex-boyfriend when we moved where we are. We needed a place to stay because I didn't have enough money for a hotel to stay another day because my apartment was taking longer. So we had to spend a couple nights at one of my ex-boyfriend's house. And he has three boys, so I didn't see a problem with it. And I had checked in with my aunts and let them know what we were going to do, just where our whereabouts were, and just checked in and let them know what was going to happen and what we were about to do and let them know the plan and everything. And so we stayed with him a couple of days. His kids like to play with my kid, and so we spent some time together doing that. And one night, me and him kind of messed up where I let him put his fingers inside of me. Mm-hmm. And so my son, the next morning, he was like, he got really mad and said, "No more spending the night, no more spending the night." And it was just like, it wasn't him talking, it was somebody else talking. Like, he was really angry and upset that he spent the night and what had happened. And then I see him, like, we went to church, and I repented. And then also I had came back home from church, and there was some blood drops on my bathroom floor on the carpet. And I was like, how is this, you know, where did this come from? Because me and my son were the only ones living there, and that wasn't there before we left. And so I smelled semen, I smelled cologne, I smelled vomit, I smelled fish, just these different things that I smelled. And it always seemed like something was tapping the mirror. But these things started to happen, and it's been happening. Like, it seems like for a long time, from when we moved from one place to the next, like something is following us.
Mm-hmm. That's because those spirits are in you. You know, it's not following you. They are with you. They are in you. So wherever
okay.
you go, they are there. And then when they want to manifest, they manifest and be in your house, and they're the one who's doing those things. It's not a human being that's doing those things in your house. It's those demon spirits. You are attached to the marine kingdom. The marine kingdom. That's why when you was in West Africa, that demon little boy, you know, saw those spirits in you and did what it did to you. Because you two both were attached to that marine kingdom. Now, is there a particular reason why you visited West Africa?
I went for school. A group of us went to take some classes. We learned some. We did some dance classes and things like that.
Okay. So your family lineage is not of West Africa.
I haven't searched back that far. I saw a lot of people who looked like me, and they said that we were family, but I don't know that to be the truth at all.
So it could be that possibility that's where your family, that's the area of Africa which your family originated from.
Because like when we were there,
uh-huh.
I apologize.
Because with me, I believe that my family originated from Ghana, because I just got this feeling that's where, you know, the black part of me, because I have Native African as well, but the black part of me, way down the line, my family originated from Ghana. But God's gonna detach you from that marine kingdom. But again, the most important thing is that you stay in obedience to God. Stay faithful to God in obedience to keep those doors closed, okay? You really need to stay close to God and so that the Holy Spirit can teach you to pray. You need to be a prayerful woman because of the spiritual warfare, okay? You need to be a praying woman. You need to keep your focus on the Lord. And asking the Lord to teach you to pray, to make, ask the Holy Spirit to make intercession through you. When you're there in your house, the Holy Spirit, make intercession through me, because he knows how to pray. He knows what to pray for. So you need to become a praying woman. Don't seek to become a preacher, a prophetess. No, you seek to become a praying woman. You need to become a praying woman in order to fight through this battle for your son, because those spirits want your son. You want your son. But you need to become a praying woman. And the only way you begin to become a praying woman is the Holy Spirit must make intercession through you. Okay? So I'm going to go ahead and pray now. So, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for this opportunity to minister your love and grace and mercy to your daughter, D. I thank you, Father, that it's time now. It's time for D to shine greatly for your glory. It's time, Father, for her to truthfully worship you spiritually. It's time, Father, for you to clean up your house for true worship. And I ask you to continue to give her more revelation and more understanding on who she is in your son Jesus, and also who Jesus is in you. Father, I thank you for the angel, the heavenly host that you have encamped around her and all her properties, Father. I thank you, Father, for cleaning her heart to make her heart just like you, Father. I thank you, Father, for cleaning her mind, her will, her emotions, and her body, her visions, and her dreams. I thank you, Father, and give you all the praise and glory. And, Father, every door that the enemy have closed off to her, that it's your will to be open, Father, I open those doors now in Jesus' name. And every door that the enemy has opened, it's your will, those doors to remain closed. And I also, Father, close those doors in Jesus' mighty name. I thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for what you're about to do in this life, in her life, even in her son's life, for every plan, every ideal, every purpose that you have for them, Father. And only bringing glory to your son, Jesus Christ, it shall be fulfilled on this earth, Father. Father, we praise you. We magnify you always. But there is nothing impossible with you. But you are the great I am, and we thank you. You are the most powerful one. No one can get above you, Father. No one can get over you, around you, or under you, Father. And we thank you in Jesus' mighty name. We sing glory and praises to your most holy name. And we thank you for delivering your daughter and your son this day, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. For Jesus died for their salvation, for their healing, and for their deliverance, Father. That is their God-given right and their benefit, Father. And we thank you, Father, for implementing those benefits in their life. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. So, Father, I'm going to take authority in Jesus' mighty name. And I come against every unclean spirit. Every unclean spirit. Every unclean spirit that has lurked and that is lurking and hiding dormantly in Dee's mind, in her will, in her emotions, in her dreams, in her visions, and even in her body, and that includes her son, James, I command you to come to attention and pack all your loads and get out of God's house. Spirit husband, pack your loads and get out of God's house and get out of Dee's house in Jesus' mighty name. For the blood of Jesus is against you. The blood of Jesus detached her from you. The blood of Jesus forgiven her. The blood of Jesus has forgiven her of her sins and her transgressions. The blood of Jesus also forgave her parents and her grandparents, her ancestors, of all their iniquities. The blood of Jesus, the covenant blood of Jesus Christ, set her totally free against you. You loose her and let her go. You loose her son and let him go in the mighty name of Jesus. Holy Ghost fire. Holy Ghost fire, search and destroy darkness that's lurking and hiding dormantly in their minds. Burn, Holy Ghost, burn every spirit in their minds that has exalted and lifted itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Ghost, set their minds completely ablaze by your mighty fire. Ransack their minds. Destroy all evil images embedded deep down in their minds. Destroy by your fire in Jesus' mighty name. Destroy every evil suggestion embedded into their memory of their mind. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn in Jesus' name. Continue to ransack their will. Burn every spirit in their will that have lifted and exalted itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn in their will in Jesus' mighty name. Continue to also burn in their emotions. Set their emotions ablaze by your mighty fire. Burn every spirit in their emotions that has exalted and lifted itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Ghost. Don't leave no area untouched in their emotions in Jesus' mighty name. Burn every negative, evil feeling, personality in their emotions. Burn, Holy Ghost. Set it ablaze by your mighty fire. Ransack her body. Ransack his body. Ransack their body. Don't leave no area untouched in their body. Burn in their eyes. Burn darkness 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 in their nostrils. In their ears. In their throat. Burn darkness that's dominantly living down in their belly. Burn, 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 burn all manner of snakes, eggs, insects, animals, sea creatures in their bellies. Burn, Holy Ghost, every spirit in their belly that is not of you. Burn by your fire. Ransack their bellies. Burn, burn, burn in her uterus, in her fallopian tubes. In her womb, in her rectum, burn in his rectum, burn in his rectum, burn all manner of darkness that has been poked in their rectum, burn, Holy Spirit, burn spiritual poisoning that has been embedded in their bodies, in their bellies, burn, Holy Spirit, burn up and down their arms, up and down their legs, burn, Holy Spirit, burn on their fingers, things that were planted on and in their fingers, burn in their toes, round their ankles, round their neck, on their head, burn, burn every evil object that has been embedded in their bellies, in their body, in their skin, burn, Holy Spirit, burn, burn, burn in Jesus' name, purify their body by your mighty fire, give them a blood transfusion of the blood of Jesus. Let the blood of Jesus flow down their bloodstream. Let the blood of Jesus flow from the crown of head to the soles of their feet. Flush out all spiritual poisoning out of their bodies. Out of their bodies in Jesus' mighty name. Continue to ransack. Ransack their bodies by your mighty fire in Jesus' mighty name. Clean their body in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, I take God's scissors in the spirit realm. I detach yourself from that ungodly covenant doctrine witchcraft. I detach them from that kingdom of darkness, from that marine kingdom. I detach them by the blood of Jesus because the blood of Jesus detached them. The blood of Jesus sets them free. I detach them from that evil relationship in the spirit realm. I disconnect them from that evil spirit marriage. Evil spirit husband, evil spirit wife, spirit family, spirit children, I disconnect them in Jesus' mighty name. For the blood of Jesus destroys all covenant. The blood of Jesus destroys all covenant from 1,000 generations and beyond. The blood of Jesus destroys all contract. The blood of Jesus destroys the covenant written in the ocean. The blood of Jesus destroys those covenants, destroys those contracts in Jesus' mighty name. I detach them in the spirit realm from every relationship the Father did not connect them to. I detach them even in the natural realm from every relationship the Father did not connect them to. I disconnect by the blood of Jesus. I disconnect in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name, Dee and Jane, be totally free. Be free in your mind. Be free in your mind. Be free in your mind. Be free in your will. Be free. free in your emotions. Be free in your dreams. Be free in your visions. And be free in your body to serve the Lord thy God in spirit and truth. And him only will you serve in Jesus' mighty name. Be free in Jesus' mighty name. Be free. Be free in Jesus' name. Father, fill Dee and James with your spirit, Father. Fill their mind. Fill their will. Fill their emotion. Fill their dream. Fill their vision. And fill their bodies with your spirit, Father. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Father, I also pray for Dee's home. We want her house free from the evil one, where she can truthfully worship you in her house as she truthfully worship you in your house. Holy Ghost fire, go in Dee's house. Search and destroy all manner of darkness that's lurking and hiding in every room, in every corner, crack, and crevice of the house. Burn by your fire. Find their dark hiding places and destroy darkness by your fire. Search and destroy. Burn darkness. Go in every bedroom. Go in every bedroom. Destroy darkness hiding under the bed, around the bed, over the bed, even in the walls. Destroy darkness that is hiding and lurking in the wall, in every closet. Destroy darkness under every couch, in every couch. Destroy darkness in every dresser. Destroy darkness. Don't leave no furniture in her house untouched by your mighty fire. Eradicate darkness by your fire. Ransack her property in Jesus' mighty name. Go in the kitchen and destroy darkness in every cupboard. Destroy darkness. Burn darkness by your fire. Go outside the house, around the house, under the house, even under the ground. I just planted there, known or unknown to her. Destroy darkness in Jesus' mighty name. Even on the clothes where darkness has attached itself, destroy darkness on the clothes, on the jewelry. Destroy darkness on the toys, on that trinet. Destroy darkness. Don't leave no area untouched in her house, even electronically destroyed, even destroy darkness that is hiding in the plugs of the wall. Destroy darkness in the electrical unit. Destroy darkness. Don't leave nothing untouched by your mighty fire. Destroy darkness that have attached itself to the doorknobs of every room of the house. Destroy darkness in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, for setting your daughter totally free to serve you in spirit and truth, and setting her prophetess free in Jesus' mighty name. We praise you, we magnify you, we exalt your name forever. In Jesus' name, you are free, Dee. In the mighty name of Jesus, you are free. Glory to your holy name. Glory to your holy name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. We magnify you always in Jesus' mighty name. Dee, you are totally free. As I told Bryant this morning, well, earlier, I see now that we have been disconnected. But Dee, those deliverance prayers was against the Marine Kingdom. They heard God's instruction, and they have left, and you are totally free. Now, as the Lord did Brian, he's going to lead you back to listen to this. And I don't know how long we've been disconnected, but now you heard what the Lord have said, and you are set totally, totally free in Jesus' mighty name. And you can do as Brian. You can call back on one of the other days. If you don't call back today before I hang up, finish session today, you can call back and give your testimony as to what you experienced. Because that was a mighty, mighty battle, Dee. That was a great battle in the spirit realm. The Lord fought on your behalf. And those demons, they had to flee from you and your son. But the Lord still wants you as his mother to lay hands on him and for you to exercise your authority in him in commanding these those spirits. Even though they out, but God still wants you to do it, to command them to come out of his mind, his will, his emotions, and his body in Jesus' mighty name. And then every night before he goes to sleep, you put your hands on his head and you speak a blessing over his life in Jesus' mighty name. Praise his holy name. Thank you, Jesus, because you are totally, totally free in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So, dear heart, she haven't returned the call, but I see I have one other caller, like from the UK. So I'm going to go ahead and bring on the UK. Now, UK, I'm going to bring you on, but if Dee happened to call back before I finish a session with you, I'm going to put you on hold so I can quickly finish her session and encourage her that she was indeed set free, and then I will get back to you. That's if she calls back, because for some reason we were disconnected. She may had her battery may have went low. So I'm going to bring UK on. Okay. All right, UK. You calling in for a session? Hello? Hello? If you can hear me, I cannot hear you. Well, I cannot hear you, so I'm going to mute you. And I'm going to give it a couple more minutes. And if Dee doesn't call in, then I'm going to go ahead and end session for today. So I don't know if you're just merely listening or if there's difficulty in which I cannot hear you, because I cannot hear you. I'm going to go ahead and mute you. So if you happen to be calling in for a session and for some reason I'm not hearing you, I am having sessions again on tomorrow, Friday only, August the 12th at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So feel free to call back then if you are interested in a session. All right. All right. All right. Praise the living God. So, dear, I got disconnected from the other caller, so I don't know what exactly happened here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and end the session for today. Now, remember, for August the 12th, Friday, August the 12th only, I'm conducting deliverance session, because I've been out 4 to 6 weeks, so I've been having a lot of calls. So for those of you who maybe called in and didn't get through, you can try again on tomorrow, Friday, August the 12th only, at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, okay? All right, then. Everyone, remember, I host call-in deliverance sessions every Wednesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you can call our deliverance conference line, 712-770-4005, and enter participant code 828-344. Praise the living God. So stay blessed in Jesus' mighty name. Shalom.